From Carolla One Studios in Glendale, California, this is the Adam Carolla Show. Adam's guest today, Dan Dunn. With Gina Grant on news, Paul Bryan on sound effects, a phone call from Brad Williams, and we'll play the Rotten Tomatoes game. And now, his relationship with his mom is so bad, he started forgetting Mother's Day a week early just to get ahead. Adam Carolla.
Yeah, get it on. Got to get on. The church will get on. Mandate. Get it on. Thanks for tuning in. Thanks for telling a friend. We love that about you, right, Gina Grant?
That's right.
And Paul Bryan.
You make me disgusted.
Well, we're getting an update on Dawson's sets from over the weekend. And
I got a live in-time play-by-play from Brad, and that's all I'm going to say about that.
Well, he's going to come and check with us pretty soon, so we'll get into that with him. I had a weekend filled with girls' volleyball.
Oh, you lucky devil.
And like I say, it's always far away. It was Tustin, California.
Okay.
That's the jewelry district in Tustin with the
buy
waving.
You a car when you're there.
That's all I know about Tustin.
Yeah, it's a nice city. It's right there, right on the border of Irvine. They have that. We had to leave at about 6:10.
Ooh-wee.
Because they have to play, I counted, 11 games to 25.
Wow.
Now, I'm saying it's like, imagine your parents watching you play like 11 Little League games in a row.
No, they're 11 in a season.
Right. And season. They used to have seasons.
Right.
There are no more seasons anymore. But you drive really far away at really early in the morning, and then you get there, and the first game's at 8 a.m., and it's $20 to park.
Oh, wow.
You have to pay to do this?
Wow.
You got to pay $20 to park, and then you have to pay $10 to get into the facility. Which...
And this is a club team. You pay for her to play.
Yes.
This isn't the school team that she made, JV or whatever.
No, you have to go, you have to pay,
wow,
and you have to stay. That's the thing. And I mean, it is...
Pay for stay.
Yeah.
It starts at 8 a.m. as, you know, tip off, and it doesn't stop till after 1.
That's
so
wild.
It is 5 hours.
Ugh.
Of... And I thought to myself, that's like almost 2 Super Bowls. It is watching...
Good point.
It's a weird thing. Like, I don't know what the conceit is. Like, you would like to watch this thing for so long that it's... I'll give you a basic example. Gina,
yeah.
Diet be damned. What's your favorite food?
Oh, God. Macaroni and cheese.
Mac and cheese. I need you to eat a vat of it. Yeah. And when you're full, I'm going to keep ladling it into your mouth until eventually you're angry at mac and cheese.
I mean, I would love to eat, like... If we're going
now,
for it, like 3 bowls.
5 hours of nonstop mac and cheese.
I
you will be angry at mac
up.
And cheese,
yeah,
by the time we're done with this odyssey.
No, thank you.
So you just watch
like
and you
Homer
watch.
Homer Simpson, the donuts.
Yeah.
And you watch.
And all the donuts in the world.
And the other thing, we were talking about that thing where everyone gets congratulated, whether they... So...
Were they played or not?
Well, no, but like in the NBA... When the guy goes to the free throw line, he makes it, everyone slaps his hand.
Sure,
he misses it.
A lot of fit bumps.
Mm. Right. But at least you can tell if he made it or not.
Right.
We're sitting on this court. It didn't have, the scoreboard wasn't working.
Oh, good.
So when
That's
one
what
of
you're
the,
paying for.
When one of the girls would whack the ball across the court, you wouldn't know if it was in or out because it was kind of far away, hit the ground. And then they would congratulate her. But I wasn't sure if we got the point.
Consoling her,
right,
or they
right,
just
right.
congratulate.
It's the same congratulations. We need to work out a sign.
Yeah, thumbs up, thumbs down.
We need something. I don't think thumbs down is going to cut it in today's world.
I know volleyball, the girls all come together, right? A little like mini huddle after every point.
That the mini huddle thing happens periodically.
Okay.
A weird down on the floor and slap the hardwood from the sideline ritual takes
new.
Place as well.
I've never seen an indoor volleyball
it's
game.
It's just unclear if the chick who serves made it before the stripe or after stripe, because they all just give her the handsy, miss the free throw,
right,
or made the free throw. It's all the same move.
For a point, high five. For a missed point or a fault or whatever, pat on the head.
That's perfect.
Still
we know.
So there's that. There's 5 hours of that. Then you got to get all the gals in after they change. That's an Italian of friends, and you got to do in and out.
Oh, sure.
And then in and out has a line of 41 cars.
That's right.
Because
always.
You're in Irvine, you're in Orange County, and it's 145, and there's there's no longer, like, remember when you'd pull up to in and out, there'd be six cars, and you're like, that's a lot of cars. They're 47 cars.
Yeah, they're now spilling onto the street.
Oh, it just goes right into the parking lot of the Bed Bath and Beyond.
Yeah.
It just like keeps going.
Yeah,
in and out, they will have, like, they will put cones in the street to block off a lane because that is a lane dedicated to turn into in and out.
Right.
Cahuenga.
So then you do this move, which is you size up the line. And you make the decision. Do you get in the line of cars or do you go in?
Go in.
Right. So then what I have to do is I have to pick the car I would have been behind. And I have to pray.
Yes.
I have to pray that that person doesn't get to the window before Natalia comes out with the burgers.
Or your day is ruined.
Ruined. Yep. So I was staring at this black Cadillac SUV, and I was like, that's our car. I have to keep my eye on that car to make sure we would have slid in behind that guy, praying that he doesn't move along too fast or maybe suffers a stroke or something along the way, needs medical assistance. But Natalia's been in there for 20 minutes now, but there's a long line, and I'm staring at the car, and I actually get out just to stretch my legs, and the guy in the black Cadillac, that's the car that I've wished, not death, but, you know, I've
certain
just, it's like your kid's running in a race, another kid, he hope he trips.
Right.
You know, that's kind of, the guy rolls
some
down the
misfortune would fall.
Misfortune. Yeah. The guy rolls the window down and goes, hey, Smith! No. Starts honking his horn.
Give me
and
a burger.
I was going to say, that's your man.
A pox upon your vehicle! I was just sitting in my car staring at your car, hoping that you did not.
A mild stroke,
so that you didn't beat my daughter out of there with the burgers. Not that it has anything to do with anything. It was just the decision we made. And the guy rolled this window down. Well, he went around and he turned the corner and started. Now, I actually had to go walk it on the side to see where the window was,
it's
to
important.
See how many cars would have. Once they turn the corner, I can't see how many cars are there. Mm. Natalia was, you know, waiting outside, and we ended up, I did that move where I'm like, I'll have the double-double. No fries, no shake. I got to watch my diet. Then I end up finishing off Natalia's fries and her shake as we're driving home because she got everything and didn't want to finish
it. Did she get well-done fries animal style?
No. I don't think she's up to that.
I would just love to watch someone eat that right now.
Up to that challenge. Then the
cuckold food.
God, it happens.
Then I had this other thought involving time, which is when I was at this big sports facility, everyone shows up, and then everyone introduces themselves as someone else's mom,
sure,
and or dad.
Sure,
there's that, which is always nice. And then I never know the name of the child they're talking about, but they always come. They go, "I'm Cindy's mom," and I go, "Oh, there she's a delight! What a delight!" And then they do something that costs me money. They go, "Hey, thanks, appreciate Disney World.
Very generous.
And the plane tickets and everything. Sweet of you." And I'm like, I don't remember sign off on that.
The
but
Disney
okay.
tickets would have been enough, but the guide, the private guide.
Yeah. Yes, and the tartan skirt. Yeah. And so
lunch with Mickey was just over the top. Yeah.
I got a lot of that. And then I was going to take all the girls to go sleep in Malibu, and a couple of thoughts about that. First, when I was in the facility, I had this thought, which is, as I was heading to the men's room, there was no line for the men's room, but of course there was a line to get into the women's room.
Always.
And I thought, there's about an equal number of moms and dads in this place, probably broken at 50-50 male-female in this place in terms of viewership. So then I realized, well, obviously the process is a lot slower in the women's room. It's not like there's more women here. There's just slower.
Yeah.
So I saw them in line, And I always feel a little weird, because especially when you have to go to the bathroom, you walk right past the line of women and you go right into the men's
that
thing,
is
which,
toxic masculinity.
Which is empty. But I thought, you know, women live like 5 years longer than men. Mm-hmm. Or maybe it's 3 years. Mm-hmm. It's a number.
It's 3 years. Yeah.
We outpace.
Live a number of years.
Yeah.
And then I thought, I bet if you broke it down, that number would be exactly the same amount of time they waited to use the bathroom.
Wow. Yeah.
And then I thought, okay, we're even.
Yeah, sporting
we're
events.
Even.
You might be right about that.
We're
when they
even.
Say, like, you spend a third of your life sleeping. You
right.
know, this is good.
Yeah, or like, they go, you spend 10,000 hours in traffic every 5 years or whatever. It's like, yeah.
I think you're right.
I think you added up all the bathrooms.
I think you're right.
3 years in line.
And we've talked about this, I think, before.
I think we're even.
I wouldn't change it.
I'm actually feeling good about dying early.
Ahead,
yeah.
I wouldn't change it, because if our option was to just sidle up together next in a trough with some ice in the bowl, I would say, no thanks, I'll wait for the one stall with the 100 women in front of me. Hmm. What you guys have to, well, I know you don't give a shit around here, that damn door's always open, but
right.
I can't fathom being like, hey everyone, I'm just gonna pop a squat and everybody enjoy the show.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
Please.
Yeah, well, the good news, I mean, for guys, we just kind of turn our back to society, you know, when it comes to the urination.
Yeah, but you still have peripheral vision.
Yeah, it depends. It depends how high the dividers are.
But like at the Dodgers or whatever, isn't it just a trough?
It's a trough. Yeah. It,
mind your own business.
Wrigley thinks that. Wrigley
famously had the dudes who would
slide through it.
Good
please.
Yeah, that's awesome. I love those guys. Well, now not only have the dividers, but they have the Lexan hanging above the dividers.
Oh,
which
what is
that? That's just COVID shit.
Okay.
This,
look at you guys.
Little extra measure.
Never mind.
We had, men live 6 to 8 years less, or women live 6 to 8 years longer?
Yeah.
It's funny. I always just said 7 years, but I actually tried to look it up when I got back to my chair, and I couldn't find it. I couldn't find the info I was reading was different. So women live six of the average seven. 7 years.
All year spent in line for the toilet.
Yeah. And I'm not saying every one of them spends exactly seven. There's some concert goers.
Right.
There's some Jimmy Buffett fanatics who've seen 157 Jimmy
Parrot
Buffett
heads.
Shows that probably spend 13 years in line.
Season tickets for the Seminoles.
Yes.
You know what
right.
I mean? They're constantly in line.
Yeah. Right. All right. So it made me feel good. And I was glad I could put those thoughts together.
How many girls did you host at this little sleepover?
All in four.
Okay.
And lots of did the in and out thing on the way home. All those stupid rules, you know, like no eating in the car and no, you know, no.
They give you a placemat, for God's sake.
Fuck it. Did that. Then I started thinking about my dad and his relationship with Pee Wee Sports.
Hmm.
And I thought, well, so
limited.
Yeah.
Well, think about this for a second and picture it through your adult eyes who've had a little therapy and learned a few things about life.
That was Pop Warner.
My dad didn't make all the games, but there's two incidents that I sort of forgot about. One is, as I've discussed, but probably not in a long time, if he did go to the game, he never sat up in the bleachers.
What'd he do?
He never sat up in the bleachers. Now,
hide behind the concession stand?
I'll set the table by saying, when I found out I was going to Tustin to watch 6 hours of Pee-wee girls volleyball, my first thought I had was, I got to bring like three notebooks and see if I can pen a novel.
Yeah.
Well, I can't just sit here and watch the same girls play volleyball for 6 hours. I have to bring a binder and some pen.
Absolutely.
I got
notes.
New
comedy special. It's all volleyball based.
But then I thought about the optics, and the optics is going to be Natalia looking at me with my, you know, wearing a green visor that's with a shade in it, like an accountant, and like buried in some paperwork or
your
something.
Nose in a book,
it's not going to look good.
No.
So I brought a small notepad, but my dad, when he did go to the games, would not sit up in the stands with the rest of the parents. He would place himself on the sideline about the 20 on a short, like, low boy folding chair.
He wanted to be there for goal line stands. Come on, buddy.
He would go down at the 20. He'd unfold a chair, pull himself back, you know, off the sideline a bit. It's like a high school field, you know, somewhere near the track on the 20, not near the sideline or, you know, not near where the action was, the bench was. Pull himself aside and pull out a huge book and just sit there. Now, I remember being nine on the field looking at him, but he was buried in a book. And I also thought I could tell that when I was nine, but I wasn't really thinking about the optics of the other parents.
How does it look?
I played both ways, never left the field. And he's got his head buried in a book sitting off the side. And by the way, when the action got down to the other goal line, he was 100 yards away. He didn't know what was going on. And also, when you're sitting on one of those beach folding chairs that's 4 inches off the ground.
It's not great bird's eye view.
No, the reason they build bleachers is so you can sit at the 50 and kind of purvey.
Right. Stadium seating for a reason.
Yeah, you can survey all that you see.
Right.
So I was...
The offensive coordinator sits in one of those low boys at the 10-yard line.
I have no idea who has the ball. So I was thinking about it, but I was also thinking everybody in the stands could see that he had set up over here in this perch where he couldn't see anything and was reading a book the entire time. So, forget about the message he was sending to me. What about the others?
Yes.
You know, what was he saying? I cannot sit amongst you, your unwashed masses.
You would distract me from my task at hand.
Of reading a book. And why, you know, the game is 4 10-minute quarters or something. We used to play 4 12-minute quarters. I'm trying to think. We used to play
an hour and a half all in.
Pop Warner, all in an hour and a half.
Halftime.
All in with halftime and eating the orange wedges that the good mom cut up.
Quick question: was this the field near your house?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's not like he was just giving you a ride. He didn't have to show up at all. So why bother if you're just going to stick out like a sore thumb that you don't give a shit?
Well, I think he had a conundrum, which is I don't want my son talking shit about me on his syndicated radio show one day about not supporting him and his one love, which is Pop Warner football. I shall show up. But I certainly don't want to watch him play.
Right.
That would be a waste of my time.
Right.
That's the conceit.
Right.
Even though I was a standout, which is also interesting. I get it when your kids...
How would he know?
Right. I get it when your kid's riding the pine the whole time.
Yeah.
It's kind of, you still go to support, but they're not getting a lot of reps in out there. I never left the field and was kind of a standout. So it was an interesting, message he was kind of putting forth to me, the other parents, and arguably the universe. But then I do remember this incident. We had a running back named Bauer. Maybe it was John Bauer. Can't remember.
Jack Bauer.
Yeah.
Jack Bauer.
We're number 24.
Only knew last names. Everyone just knew everyone's last name. There's no first names in Pop Warner football.
So not on the jersey.
Whatever's your last name is who you are. Coach has never called you by your first name. Yeah. You certainly never called them or anybody else. It was all last names.
Did you have the coaches do the thing on the first day of, or first days of spring practice or fall practice, whatever? They put your name masking tape on the helmet because they didn't know who everyone was there, you know? There could be people from freshman or JV or whatever.
Yeah, we didn't. I don't know why we didn't have that. And we probably didn't have that because it would be the same group and the same coaches. So Duke Gallagher would coach his son, Danny Gallagher. And then he'd start them off in farm.
Uh-huh.
And then the next year, they'd both move up to Gremlins. And then the next year, they both move up to Tiny Mites and Mighty Mites and Bantams and Peewees and stuff. They'd all just move right through the ranks. So it'd be the same block of kids, give or take a couple of stragglers here and there, that would just move all the way through
the system.
So they knew who you were.
But real quick, none of those names you just mentioned seem bigger than the other one. So that had to be Tiny Mites, Mighty Mites, Little Guys, Pee-wees.
Yeah.
How do you know what level's what? It's like arbitrary, like what a karate belt looks like to the rest of us.
The orange, red, green.
Right.
Yeah. It's, I mean? It's the terror, alert color code system. Yeah. There was farm. I guess farm. I don't know what farm meant.
No.
It was farm was, well, they also called
like the farm team.
They called them the Trobabes.
The hell does that
mean? Seven.
That should
like
be the
babies.
Cheerleaders.
I know.
The cheerleaders
Trojan.
Were
we were Trojan babies. Trobabes. But they were farm, then gremlin, then mighty might, then another year mighty might, then peewee, then midget, then bantam.
There is no way to tell this
sense.
Apart.
I know. Perfect ascension.
I think they're doing it just to see if you're paying attention.
Yeah, apparently.
Are you committed to this or not?
It's the red or it's the green M&M in
right.
the rider.
I want to know if you're reading the rider. So
work hard in 7 years, you could be a peewee.
This one game when I was about 10, Bauer broke away. He was a running back. He just scooted right down the middle, and he just broke away right down the middle for like a 40, 50-yard run, like a long run for a 10-year-old. And there were two guys chasing him, and they were kind of on his heels for a while. And then I ran down the field, and then at some point it was all three of us just sort of chasing Bauer at the same speed, essentially. The thing about 10-year-olds, the skilled position guys are about the same speed as the non. Everyone's about the same size. Mm-hmm. It's not like the pros where the guy runs away and no one's going to catch
him.
Just
chase that kid.
Yeah, and we're all chasing him. And at some point with these two guys chasing him, I just threw a cut block and just they both like flew up into the air. And it was such a revelation because Bauer was just doing what he was told to do. Here's the ball, you know, run that direction. What I did was considered more praiseworthy because at such a young age, I ran down the field and cut blocked these two guys and took them both out.
High football IQ.
Yeah, and it was that's the kind of thing the 10-year-olds didn't do. And so when we came to the sideline after he scored, the team kind of surrounded me and not so much Bauer because everyone scored a touchdown. We'd score three or four running touchdowns every game, but you wouldn't see one of these cut blocks where he took out two guys. That was a big deal. And I remember my dad, who was sitting, thankfully we're playing on his goal.
Oh, good.
He saw all the commotion as I was like coming off the field and the team was like kind of surrounding me.
Hoisting you high.
My dad, you know, he put down Moby Dick and he got up and he started to walk toward me because he wanted in on this thing now. And I blew him off. I gave him the high hat.
You gave him the stiff arm.
I just kind of gave him the, all right. And I just kind of ran past him
you
to the.
You proud of me now, Daddy?
No, I didn't do any. I didn't do any of that. And then when we were driving home that game, remember that he was in the car and he was pissed.
At you?
Yeah.
For snubbing him?
Yes.
Wow.
I remember
Forget
that.
Forget him, the Heisman.
Yeah.
Stiff arm.
And then I thought, I think that guy's a narcissist. I think that's what's going on. Not at the time.
No.
I probably said stuck up. But I was thinking about that as I was just, you know, when you have 6 hours to watch volleyball, you can really examine some chapters in your life.
At the very least, at 10 years old, you'd probably be thinking, why was what I just did somehow about my dad? Why is he making it about him?
I got it. Like, I blew him off.
Right.
And he didn't like it.
Wow.
And he was probably probably a little humiliated because he stood up and now everyone in the stands could kind of see what was going on. And it didn't feel good. And I understood that much.
Right.
But now I'm looking at him and I realize now that I know many other personality traits that he possesses that I think he's a bit of a narcissist.
Well, the good news is since he knew how that felt, he internalized it immediately. And after that, he had the foam finger. He, you know, was the pep squad.
Turned it all around. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's right. So that was good. Wow. Then I stepped in tar at the beach.
Oh, mazel.
And I don't know if you guys have stepped in tar in a long time, but it does not come off.
Especially at the beach. Just and like sand.
As Brian likes to say, it's gum on steroids.
I immediately got angry at the guys with the pine tar and the helmet who are playing baseball now, because it took me 40 minutes to get a quarter-sized piece of tar off the ball of my foot.
Scrape it off.
You just can't do the pine tar rag and make it to home plate from the dugout without going, I need more pine, I need tar, it's lost its adhesion. Fuck you. All right, Gina, you celebrated a birthday.
I did, thank you. My fiance was nice enough to give the kid an arbitrary number for him to write in my birthday card. I guess I'm celebrating 34. Oh, nice. So happy birthday to me. We got a couple of pictures. It was nice. They decorated the living room, you know, before we left on our trip. And I got some things from the five-year-old. He decided I needed a lemon juicer.
You ended up at Joshua Tree?
Ended up at Joshua Tree, but had to, you know, fake some real hardcore enthusiasm about this juicer.
Mm-hmm.
Like just a little lemon one that you know, rub on the top. Keep going. He got me a cup, which was very nice.
What you got for lemon juice?
Obviously. And he's just a sweetheart. So we had a great little time, and then we ditched him. And we went to the desert. Just keep scrolling and all. So the first thing we did, you know, I love the Integratron.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's my place. So I took Andy for the first time. That's exactly right. So you sit in front of that. You get the whole speech about George Van Tassel. And
so it's got like a missile silo kind of a look.
And the sad thing was, apparently, George built this to like stop time and to stop the aging process. But he died right before he turned the machine on.
Yeah.
So that was sweet irony.
That was a real blow.
What year was that?
That was in the 50s.
Oh, well, then we would have never been born if he was successful, right?
He started it in the 50s and he died in the 70s. But well, he was
a good run.
Took a while. Yeah. Apparently, he worked with Howard Hughes, and this is like this they're called ley lines that these are on, which is like geomagnetic forces, and this converging river underneath the water, underneath the ground, and it's all full of like alien energy. So anyway, it was an outdoor one because that's how we're rolling these days, and I provided some audio.
Wait, what's an outdoor one?
Yes.
Normally
you sit
they put
in front
them
of
indoors,
the
right, and do the whole sound bath.
Exactly.
Thing.
So I usually am in the dome on top.
Mm-hmm.
And they weren't letting people do that, so you just sit around these speakers, but it was beautiful out and it got really starry. So this is what it sounds like. There are these giant crystal quartz singing bowls.
Dumau-mau.
They just let you go into another dimension.
It is very nice. I've done this before. Nice.
And it goes on for like 40 minutes. And like sometimes I fall asleep, sometimes I hallucinate, sometimes nothing happens. But it was just really like, it was great. So we did that.
Did you used to like smoke marijuana before this?
No.
Can one?
Oh, of course.
Smoke a marijuana cigarette?
Yeah, the devil's cabbage, Ryan. I used to.
Smoke marijuana.
I used to, but
dude,
now.
Just cannabis before this?
Now I like to go in a little clear-headed. But yeah, I'm sure there are a lot of high people there. There was like 50 people.
Mm-hmm.
So it was great.
They smoke marijuana?
Mm-hmm. Oh, my God. Then we went back to the little desert hideaway I found. Because I like to find literally off the beat. I mean, my tires. I'm turning the car in this week. The tires are fucked. I don't know if that's going to affect the lease. But
you found some desert hideaway.
Oh, yeah.
See, and my thing is like, where's the P.F. Chang's?
No.
I want consistency.
There was
I'm not rolling the dice
there
with hideaways.
There was a Walmart, and now I am totally 100% team Walmart.
Mm.
Down with Target, up with Walmart. I feel like Walmart's my discovery, my little secret. I don't want too many people to know about this place I found.
Those popular
They have everything, and the prices are unbeatable. Anyway, I got up the next day, and we were just, you know, put on a little sundress, and we were kind of doing a little photo shoot. There's an Edsel, apparently.
Yeah, it
I
is.
I didn't know that was an
Edsel. Old Edsel parked in the desert.
What passes as art in the desert is amazing. Burnt out trash and sinks turned over and toilets. That's like, they're like art installations.
Everything you're describing is my nightmare.
I love it.
Have you guys, in just basic desert talk, and I'll put this out to everybody.
Yeah.
I walk back and forth to the shops a lot during the week. I think I've noticed 30% more lizards. this year. I'm seeing a ton of lizards.
Literally one today on our bricks. It's us playing with.
Andy and I were talking about that. Yes.
There's 30 to 41% more lizard activity in this area.
You're right.
Is it the COVID thing? Did people step on them before?
Just 3 hours ago.
They become bold and emboldened. I'm more lizards this year.
Yeah. You're absolutely right about that.
It's a very dry year. Is this something to do with the lack of rain?
It's got something to do with something. I just keep noticing lizards everywhere.
We totally agree with you. And of course, tons of lizards and critters. A lot of jackrabbits, a lot of roadrunners. Just keep scrolling.
This is one of those yardsticks to measure not only are you an old fart, or has life been beaten out of you? Because I used to be intrigued by lizards.
Yeah.
I'm now annoyed. Get the fuck out of here.
Are
I'm walking to work. Come on now. I almost stepped on you.
Oh,
come on, wake up.
Speaking of that.
Pick a direction.
The neighbor, and by neighbor, I mean, I don't know, 200 yards down the road, he came out because we were kind of lost for a second. This old, this leathery, weather-beaten man. He's
31-year-old.
Like, he goes, what are you looking for? We give him the address. Like, ah, sweetie, we don't do addresses over here. What's the name? And we give him the name. Oh, yeah, I even have a key to his house, which was uncomfortable.
Oh, no.
And then he's walking away, and he's like,
I'll see you tonight.
He goes, I've lived here for 35 years. And I go, do you like it out here? He already turned around. He's already walking away, and all you hear is, I go, do you like it down here? He goes, shit, yeah. And that was our only conversation. So keep going. So, okay. Then, for my birthday on Saturday, I decided, I hear tale that there is a baby goat hike you can go on in the deep desert for five and a half miles.
Five and a half mile hike.
Treacherous.
It's the Trail of Tears.
Goat country. So I got to hold one of the babies, and there's like 20 goats. They are like rambunctious dogs. They are so funny, and they love to rear up on each other and headbutt, and it got crazy. And we're walking through.
Do the goats know the way?
The goats are total pack animals. They do not want to be separated from each other. So they are completely, they stick together. They rove together everywhere. And there's a guide, and these are his babies, and he just like clicks and snaps and claps, and they just follow him everywhere like dogs. So it was treacherous because we didn't have kids in our group because there was 10 of us. We got to go the crazy way.
We have gotten to the point with our society that we now
do this with others.
It gets booked pretty quickly.
We pay to do what formerly you were paid
to do.
Like you would have be hard pressed explaining this to someone
I'm
from
herding goats
1822
for fun.
Yeah. That this cost you money.
Yeah, not cheap. And that's I was like, you know what? Good for them. Good for this racket. Because I realized when we were walking, this guy's taking the goats out anyway. Mm-hmm. Like, he might as well charge a bunch of city folk to come and walk with him. Mm-hmm. And, the views were insane, and the weather was perfect. And Andy did get goat piss all over his foot. But beyond that, it was great. And afterwards, he invited us for a beverage. Do you have that picture?
Better be goat's milk.
We had a lemon ginger herbal yerba something that he picked along the way, and fresh out the teat goat's milk.
Wow. Mm.
I gotta tell you.
Is that unpasteurized?
Oh, very much so. Very unpasteurized, and I drank a lot of it.
Really?
It was so goddamn good.
Good sign for Andy later on that night, by the way. That's
you drank goat's milk out of the teat.
You see her going... You see her just taking that goat's milk and dripping down her cheeks. She just can't get enough.
So good.
She hasn't breathed yet. Look at her.
So refreshing.
Oh, man. Yeah.
It was so creamy and like butter, like whipped cream. It was insane. It was so good. I mean, it tastes better than cow's milk. I don't know the difference.
Is it? Now, my grandfather would always bring, he'd pull out the buttermilk.
Sour, right?
I don't even know. I don't know if they sell. I haven't even seen buttermilk.
You just cook with it.
It's for
chicken fingers.
And even when I was like 11, he'd be drinking the buttermilk during the summer. And he would always go, so refreshing. It's so refreshing.
Is it?
Well, here's what I would say to the old man. I'd go, is it refreshing Or do you really not want to drink that much of it because it sucks? You know what I mean? Because his thing was like, just one little bit, man. Yeah. You're so refreshed. You know what I mean? Whereas if you were drinking one of your sodas or beer or something, you need a big thing of it. It's like, yeah, but I enjoy that. Yeah. I don't think you enjoy this. But I would drink it, and it was tasted like thicker, sour milk.
Yeah, this is not sour
But it was
anyway.
Kind of okay, I remember, in a weird way.
So this was delicious, and that, and we were exhausted afterwards. I mean, it was treacherous, and went back, and I mean, no TV, no nothing, just hanging out, you know, backed in a fool, drinking some White Claws, running around outside in the dark, and you know, and there's like Buddha statues, and there's stuff like built into the mountains you can go sit on, and it was awesome, just what I needed.
I'm now afraid for your wedding.
Yeah.
Terrified.
You're gonna love it. It's the pedestrian version of the kind of shit that I like. You'll be okay.
All right. Let me hit Rex MD. Men hate going to the doctor, especially about the sensitive stuff, but a lot of men's health issues have pretty simple solutions. RexMD.com. Get generic Viagra easily, all online from the comfort of your own home, and it'll be delivered right there, right to where you want it delivered. Right now, sample packs of generic Viagra are available for my listeners. Just fill out a quick medical questionnaire on their website. A doctor reviews your situation and prescribes you the generic Viagra. If appropriate, then it's sent free. Two-day shipping to your home. Fast, transparent, affordable, and you can access your RexMD physician anytime you need it afterwards. It is RexMD, right, Dawson?
It's never been easier to take control of your health. Those sample packs of Viagra, of generic Viagra, Adam mentioned, are available for our listeners, but you got to go to RexMD.com/Adam to get them. To make sure, you go to RexMD.com/Adam. That's RexMD.com/Adam.
All right, Brad Williams is going to call in from Brea, I guess.
Yeah,
he's out there doing a show. And is going to give us a little update on Dawson's comedy sets right after this.
It's time to check Adam's voicemail.
Hey, Adam. Ray from Vegas. Doing two of your favorite things right now. Late night Home Depot run and driving through red turn arrows. Been through two of them. Guess how many times I got pulled over? Zero. That's right. Changed my life. Love the show. Later, Hosen.
You can leave us a message at 888-634-1744.
Yeah, run through those arrows. Liberating people. All right. Appleton, Wisconsin coming up this weekend. Skyline Comedy Club is almost sold out. So if you want that, better hop on those tickets, and we'll do a live pod there, and then we'll do stand-up as well. Speaking of stand-up, Brad Williams on line one. Brad?
Hello there, Carolla Show, or should I now say the Mike Dawson Show, because he owns this bit.
Wow. So give us a little recap.
It was amazing. We were at the Bray Improv, and Mike Dawson wanted to do himself some stand-up. And I have kind of an open door policy with my friends. If my friends want to do stand up, if they want to try it, they can always do a guest spot on one of my shows. And Mike is the only guy that's ever followed through with that. And he went on stage. I went to the side of the, I went out in the audience to watch him. I was nervous as hell, and probably more nervous than he was. And he killed it, man. Wow. He did a great job. His timing was good. Pacing was great, and people just fell in love with that stoner smoker voice. It was awesome.
Well, now normally the way it works is you have an MC, and they open, they do about 8, maybe 10 minutes or something. Then you have the feature, that guy does 20 minutes, and then the headliner, that's you, right?
Yeah. We put Mike on after the host. So there was an opportunity where if he crashed and burned and failed miserably, that the feature act can go up and kind of
salvage,
mop up, kind of fix the situation. But he didn't have to do that.
And he did the Late Show Friday and Saturday?
Yeah, Late Show Friday, Late Show Saturday. Did better on the Saturday show, kind of tweaked a few things, made some adjustments. One thing that I appreciated that Mike did is I've given guest spots to people for 7 minutes, and they'll go on with a notepad, and during a seven-minute set, they'll check their notes and be like, what else are we going to talk about? It's like, you got 7 minutes. Go.
Right.
And Mike had it all prepared. He had all his bits well rehearsed, and you can tell that he took time and wrote these jokes. Like, they were well written jokes. He wasn't just winging it.
Is there anything worse than lazy as it meets opportunity? Is there any worse quality? And it is kind of insane that people who are lazy, not like Mike or yourself, but I'm just saying, the people I know who are lazy, they were lazy in the 10th grade when they had to do an oral report. And they'd be equally as lazy at the Kennedy Center. Right. Talking and inducting Shaka Khan into the African American Hall of Fame or something. They would just bring it to that. It's crazy when people get up on stage and think that they bring the same lethargies they bring to their shitty job they had 20 years ago.
Yes, and sometimes it reminds me of like you talk about, like, spoken word. Like, let's call it spoken word, so if it's not funny, it's okay. It sometimes comes across like when you go up on stage with a notebook and have that kind of laissez-faire attitude, that it's kind of a crutch. Like, well, I was just kind of, you know, fucking around anyway.
Yeah. Right. So, Dawson, let's hear from you. How did you feel up there?
I felt that it did go surprisingly well. I was nervous as hell. Incredibly nervous.
I love that.
I was out pacing back behind the stage, shadow boxing, and just trying to get myself pumped up.
I have to say this. Sorry, Dawson. I have to interrupt you. I've never seen someone shadow box before their set and then do well.
Oh, that's true. Well, I can tell you he's one of the rare people in the field of podcasting who has done the Golden Gloves and had to wait in pace for a long time before you got your fight and done stand-up gigs. I'll tell you something that people don't know. People understand that before people are nervous, they're going to go out and take the stage, they will do some shadow boxing. You go do the Golden Gloves before the guys get in the ring, they're doing a five-minute set.
I would have never guessed that.
Oh, hand to God.
A little crowd work in the
hand to God.
Wow.
A lot of it was in Spanish because it was a Los Angeles thing, so I didn't know, but I knew the rhythm of stand-up. Oh, yeah. It's a two-way street, Gina.
I see that now. Now it makes sense. Yeah.
Makes sense. So, doing a little shadow. It also had to confuse people out in the parking lot with you smoking, doing shadow boxing. Is this guy into fitness or not?
Seems committed.
He's got a beer between his legs. He's got a cigarette hanging out of his mouth, but he's working a sweat up.
Yeah, he did. It was that rare combination because he ordered like a Coors Light with a Jameson back before the 7 minute set, which I really appreciate the dedication to white trash for that.
Yeah.
Like it really, like, no, I'm leaning in. And so he's got a Coors Light, Jameson shot, cigarette, shadow boxing, and then he goes out and does 7 great minutes of stand-up. It's really a tribute to him.
And Dawson, did you get lit? Did you figure out, not you getting lit, but
the light?
Figure out the light?
Yes, he did.
Yeah, there's actually, the Bray Improv made it really, really easy. There's a huge clock in the back behind the sound booth, and you can't miss that clock. And I got off at...
Do they light it up?
No, or they don't light anything up.
You just do the math.
You just watch the time and get off the stage when you're supposed to get off the stage.
It's a big digital clock.
Is it countdown then, clock? So you don't have to...
No, it's a count up.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
It's a regular clock.
Yeah. So I did about 7 minutes and 30 seconds the first night. And I apologize for going over. Brad didn't care. Brad was incredibly gracious and such a great coach throughout this whole thing. And the other comedians, JB Ball and Quincy Weekly, are hilarious. and a ton of fun. We got a picture of it there.
I love that.
And it was like a master class. It was like I for the first time, you know, we've been in green rooms. We've done the Adam Carolla show on the road at improvs. We've been at the Brea Improv. Being in this green room where there were just to be counted amongst the people and get that feeling, you can't. It's a hard feeling to describe. It really felt good. And so I did the 7 minutes the first night. I was much less nervous the second night. Still a little bit nervous, but much less. Changed up the set a little bit. But I left out one part of a joke that would have gotten me to 7 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And I finished this joke, and I didn't realize until my friend told me, he said, you forgot this part of the joke. And I'm like, oh, shit. Well, that would have gotten me to 7 minutes. But the joke got a big laugh. I stood up there for a second. I looked at the clock. I'm like, shit, I'm early. What do I do? And then I remember Brad's words. Hey, man, if they laugh and you're at 5 minutes, get the fuck off the stage.
Yeah, nice.
And I sat there. I took a deep breath. I said, well, that's going to do it for me, folks. Brad said, get off the stage when you laugh. Thank you. Thank you for laughing. And for somehow,
shit, yeah,
that was funny. Somehow the crowd laughed at me getting off the stage and telling them I was done. So I don't know. It was an incredible experience. And Brad, thank you.
That's great.
Of course. And I'll tell you the same thing that I told you last night, that no headliner has ever gotten mad at an opening act for not going over their time. Right. Like if you end on a laugh a few minutes early, great. More time for me. You left on a high note. The crowd is happy. The next comic doesn't have to dig his way out. So yeah, it was a great night. I was truly surprised. Truly surprised. And in the best possible way. So Mike Dawson's going to be headlining the next Carolla cruise.
Yeah. No doubt. Well, let's get a little philosophical, Dawson. How good did you feel today?
Not good today. I don't know. It was weird. It's like
you didn't feel good.
I felt like
a little bit depressed. Yeah.
Really?
Like, yeah.
I thought you'd be riding high.
The high's over.
Yeah, I don't know.
Gotta chase that dragon.
But it's also a thing now. It's like, oh shit, I did this and I'm kind of good at it. Now I got to fucking start writing jokes.
Now you got to start writing jokes.
Now I got to write more. It's time to go back to work.
The burden of genius. Yeah. I've been living with this shit for a while now. I know what it's like. No,
I get it.
No, but
yeah, because Mike Dawson just made Fast and Furious 1, and now he knows he has to make 7 more.
Mm-hmm.
It's a franchise.
Skip past 2, would you please? That one blew.
Don't Tokyo Drift yourself.
Yeah, I think that was 3. The point is, skip past 2 and 3. Here's what everyone needs in life. I'm telling you the best medicine for your life. You pick some sort of event that's a challenge. Mm-hmm. You put it out there. The first challenge is you raise your hand. You know, you go, Brad Williams going to be playing shows in Brea in 2 months. You know, and you go, could I get in on that? So you push yourself into the gladiator field. You push yourself out onto the floor of the Coliseum. You know what I mean? Like you raise your hand. Then you watch as that date becomes closer and closer and closer. Then you prepare as that. Then you don't puss out at the very end where you come up with some bullshit you can't go out and do it. And then you go do it. And the experience you have after that is so much, it's so much more than you could have got from any textbook or any online masterclass or reading about this or anything. It's such, and by the way, it's 14 minutes, well, maybe 13 combined, maybe 12 combined out on stage, but you get more out of that 12 minutes than any other 12 minutes of your life because of the preparation and because of the fact you volunteered. Mm-hmm. You see, it's the volunteering. If somebody forces you out or you lose a bet or whatever that thing is, then that's not volitional.
Right.
This is you imposing it on yourself. So good for you, Dawson.
Thank you.
Yeah, man.
And good for you, Brad.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I just gave the guy the opportunity. He could have sucked, and we had J.B. Ball would have been up next, and he would have done great, and he would have saved the show. But, I'm just really happy that Mike got that opportunity. And really, I mean, doing one for the white guy.
That's right.
Doing one for the white guys.
It's about
out there.
Time.
Brad, a break.
Well, Brad, little did I know, but there is a kind of reverse diversity requirement in Orange County. They needed a full-size white guy on stage, or the show couldn't happen.
Right.
The two other comedians were black, as I got from the picture. Brad Williams, he's going to be at Naples Off the Hook Comedy Club, which is great.
Yeah, man.
Been there. This Thursday through Sunday. And you can go to more dates at bradwilliamscomedy.com. Brad, thanks for giving Dawson the opportunity.
No problem. Chris Loxamana, you are up next.
Ooh,
oh,
like that.
Let's do it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, buddy. Thanks, Brad.
Thanks,
appreciate
guys.
It. All right. We got the Rotten Tomatoes game to play. Dan Dunn's got his libations, and he's in the wings. And first, we'll get into some Rotten Tomatoes.
All right. Here we go.
Listen to that noise. That's a high falsetto voice. That can only mean one thing, and you can feel it.
Dawson names are flicks, and the gang makes their picks, guessing if it's rotten or fresh.
If they guess it exactly, we'll get a bonus five.
It's the Rotten Tomatoes game. You know how we do it. Give me the Rotten Tomatoes game. Now it's time to play it.
All right, so I'm sure you're all aware that the Kentucky Derby was on Saturday in Louisville. As a tribute to our fine four-legged friends, this week's Rotten Tomatoes game deals with movies that feature horses. We begin with a film about an extremely handsome horse trainer who helps a young girl and her horse on the road to recovery after a traumatizing riding accident. Adapted from one of the best-selling books of all time, Robert Redford, Kristen Scott Thomas, Sam Neill, and a young Scarlett Johansson star. In 1998's The Horse Whisperer.
Did Redford direct this?
I feel like I don't
point,
know.
I feel like at this point he was only directing films he was in.
This is one of those things, this is like your gate stuff, and then there's like got milk, and then at some point it's got commercial real estate.
Yeah.
Ernie Johnson services the Encino area.
Mm-hmm.
The Whisper, that's the problem with it. They opened up the whatever Whisper.
The Ghost
came
Whisper,
the Turtle
the
Whispers.
Dog Whisper.
Everything's a Whisper
one
now.
Of Christie's clients is a little bit difficult, and one of the people there is known as whatever the guy, the CEO's name is, the George Whisperer, because they can convince him to, you know, approve this or do that or whatever.
Right.
So it persists.
Well, yes. Ghost Whisperer was a CW show or something after this, right? Like, you're right. This
yeah,
is a thing.
We just got into the Whisperer thing.
Good. Robert Redford did direct this.
Mm.
Good to know.
All right. This is kind of movie that people like. Can't feel good.
Isn't Vinny married to Kristen Scott Thomas's sister?
Yep, Serena.
There you go.
Oh, the actress?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's her sister.
She was an actress too, Serena.
I knew Bond girl, but that's as much as I knew. All right. They liked it, but did they like it 77 or did they like it 92? Could be high.
Okay.
I think this one is up there. Everyone locked in.
Mm-hmm.
I went 83.
I was penning 77, as you said. Mm. I don't know much about this movie, but I assume it's at least okay.
I know nothing about it. 81.
The Horse Whisperer is fresh at 74%.
Oh,
nice.
In our next film, a young boy befriends a magnificent black Arabian horse after a shipwreck forces them to escape to a nearby island. When both return to America, the young boy and a former jockey work to train the horse for a big race from 1979 featuring Mickey Rooney as the jockey, the Black Stallion.
The role he was born to play.
What year did you say?
79.
Was 70? Mickey Rooney was the jockey?
Is that a TV movie?
79?
No, it was a real release.
Francis Ford Coppola.
No.
That's what it says.
Oh, he must have produced it.
Hmm. All right.
He was making Apocalypse Now in 79.
The
cool poster.
I mean, everyone's heard of these movies. I just don't know how they were received.
Don't know anything about it.
Mickey Rooney worries me.
He's a huge star at that point.
My eyes are going a little, but Brian, I think it says directed by Francis Coppola.
That's wild if that's true.
No, it says directed by Carol Ballard.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
It says next to the his name, never
did
mind.
Did not have that as part of his canon.
All right.
Coppola EP'd.
Okay.
All right. I have no idea. Ever saw it? I think horse movies and dusty movies are the movies I'm lacking.
They often go together.
Yeah.
It's a Venn diagram.
Random to horses or dust.
God, was this good? Was this terrible?
It's known as good, but I don't know it was good.
Okay.
All right. Okay. I'm going back to my original 77.
Wild guess, 68.
I stuck with my original 81.
The Black Stallion is fresh at 90%.
Holy moly.
All right.
Wow, they liked it.
Long before Armie Hammer threatened to barbecue and eat his lovers, he slipped into the stirrups of the Lone Ranger. Of course, he's backed by his faithful Indian companion Tonto, played by Johnny Depp. And who could forget the Lone Ranger's horse, Silver, who acts not only as the Lone Ranger's literal spirit animal, but also surprisingly provides some comic relief. From 2013, directed by Gore Verbinski.
That's right.
The Lone Ranger.
So this is big.
That was Armie Hammer?
It reunited the Pirates of the Caribbean crew, right, who was Gore Verbinski and Johnny Depp.
I heard this was just
canned.
Terrible.
Wasn't it bad?
Okay. God, you're getting worse at this, Brian.
Well, all right. So they hated this movie. And there are certain movies that are just bad movies and they get a bad grade. And then there are movies that seem to elicit some ire. People get angry at them.
Yeah.
I don't know why there needs to be a kind of punitive part of the judging. Like, I'm angry at this movie. And sometimes it's because they have stars and they should do better,
right,
and it should be better, or it's a story we know.
Question,
and they butchered it.
Was this pre-appropriation?
That was
or
a
mid?
Big, that was a big part of this, was Johnny Depp playing the Native American Tonto. This is a poorly conceived movie, right? So it's poorly written. It's actually really well directed. There is an action sequence at the beginning and an action sequence at the end that are magnificent. They're some of the best things you'll ever see. In the middle is 90 minutes of a shitty movie. William Fichtner plays a bad guy who like eats people's hearts.
Bill Fichtner.
Yeah, he like rips hearts out and eats them. It's a poorly conceived film.
All right, so these are the kind of movies that, you know, it's professionally made, had good stunts, it had a cast and it had a budget, it was well shot and everything, and could have just been the product weren't, you know, the stew was worse than the ingredients.
Right.
Sometimes you put all the good ingredients in and just stew just
not
comes
good.
Out bad. And that's like a mid 40s, low 50s situation, but there was some appropriation here, and for some reason, some ire.
Yeah.
I kind of remember people being
people
like,
took it personally.
Like angry at this film. And for that
I might have gone too high.
Reason, I say 22.
I said 28.
I was worried I went too high. I said 38.
The Lone Ranger is rotten at 30%.
Okay. Okay.
Mm-hmm. What'd you do, Brian, there?
28.
Oh.
Ooh.
Needed those
got
2 points.
A close game here.
In the midst of the Great Depression, a grieving businessman, a down-and-out horse trainer, and a jockey with a history of brutal injuries,
Pete,
all team up to help a temperamental, undersized racehorse become a champion. Based on the true story of one of the most successful thoroughbreds of all time, Jeff Bridges, Chris Cooper, and Tobey Maguire star in 2003's Seabiscuit.
Hmm. Saw bits and pieces.
I saw this in theater.
Well, it was nominated, right? Or something was nominated about this movie. Screenplay?
That sounds familiar. It might have been Best Picture.
Yes. Brian, thoughts?
Crowd pleasing, nothing soft around the edges, nothing challenging about this movie. It's an underdog story. I'm sure it did okay with the critics.
Hmm. Well, I'm staying consistent. I don't watch horse movies. Gina?
Yeah, I didn't see it, but I mean, I remember people wouldn't shut up about it. I knew people who saw it more than once in the theater. So
yeah, crowd pleasing.
People liked it. Yeah.
All right.
It's got a crowd pleasing element. I don't know how excellent it was as a film, but it's, you know,
got
it's
nominated.
Nominated for 7 Oscars, lost all of them, but it was nominated for Best Picture.
Was the cinematography like amazing because it was horse racing?
It was all
raising?
Very well done. You
know, nominated for Best Cinematography.
Yeah, by the numbers.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right, you guys locked in?
Yes.
I remember people loving this film. I said 89.
86.
81.
Seabiscuit is certified fresh.
Oh, yeah.
It's 77%.
Oh, yeah.
Oh,
my
gosh.
Billy Bob Thornton directs our last film, starring Matt Damon as a young man who finds himself without a home after his mother sells the ranch he grew up on. Driven by the promise of a fresh start, Damon and a friend embark on a journey to Mexico to find what remains of the Wild West. Based on another best-selling novel, Penelope Cruz, Robert Patrick, and Henry Thomas co-star. In 2000's All the Pretty Horses.
Oh, I was hoping it was going to be We Bought a Zoo. Mm.
Oh, this is tough. This is a tough one to end on. I have no goddamn idea.
This is a close-ish game.
Henry Thomas, isn't he the kid from E.T.?
E.T.
Oh.
I think
he still acts.
I'm maybe in third, but within striking distance.
Close game, I think.
Yeah, like Gene and Brian are pretty damn close right now.
What's this movie?
I don't know.
I don't
what
know.
Is it? I mean, what is
and
it?
And it also, it's like they would have these stupid names like this.
Yeah.
That there were, it felt like they're trying to get too much done with the title.
Right. Yeah.
All right.
Some passions can never be tamed.
There's a world where this is rotten. Just because, have you ever had anyone say to you, oh, you got to see All the Pretty Horses?
No.
No. I mean, unless I was standing in front of a bunch of horses and my back was turned to them, but not when they're talking about a movie, if that's what you're talking about.
What year was this?
2000.
2000.
Okay.
Hold okay.
On. I don't think about this movie.
I don't even know if it's, oh, okay.
Okay.
I'm not convinced it's a real movie.
The poster
looks fake. Yeah.
Yeah. Like this is the kind of poster, if we made this poster when we were at the man show and like the art department came in, Jimmy and me would have went, it looks lame.
Yeah,
make it
no
look like a real movie.
Yeah.
This looks like Deep Cable.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know.
All right. Everyone locked in?
Yeah.
I got to make up points. Yeah. I went 41.
Oh, I went rotten too at 59.
52. Oh.
Wow. I thought everyone was going fresh on this.
All the Pretty Horses is rotten.
Sweet.
A 32.
Damn it!
Shit.
I needed that was tough stuff.
Now I have no idea who's. What was yours? 52.
Yeah. What was yours?
59.
Mine was 41.
Oh.
Oh boy. Now we're tight.
Oh boy.
Oh boy.
Gina Grad, congratulations.
Yeah.
You are on the podium.
Thank you.
Bald Brian coming in with a big score of 63.
Shit, yeah!
Putting you firmly in third place.
Come on. That's a good third place for.
I feel like Adam and I are both winners.
Adam Carolla.
You're not, though.
With a score of 51. Beats Bald Brian. What did Gina do?
What did she do?
Ugh. It's at least second place because Bald Brian got third place. He lost this game again with a score of 63.
Not put too fine a point on it.
No, it's a
Adam
real loser's
51.
Holiday when I lose. Yeah.
Gina Grad, your score is at least good for second place. 48 for the win.
Yeah. That was tough.
Shit, yeah.
51 and 48. Wow. Tight ass game. All right. Dan Dunn is here. He's going to bring in some libations. We're going to talk about all our favorites. First, I'll tell you about Air Medicare Network. Health insurance doesn't always cover the full cost of an emergency medical flight, even with comprehensive coverage. You could get hit with substantial copays and deductibles. Plan ahead in an emergency. Air Medicare Network's Highly trained crews provide air medical transport to the nearest and most appropriate trauma center. With an Air Medcare Network membership, you pay no out-of-pocket expenses for the flight. And AMCN membership covers your entire household for as little as $85 and a year. And you can secure your financial peace of mind. And as a listener, you'll get a $50 gift card with a new membership. So what do? Visit AirMedCareNetwork.com/Adam. Protect your family for just $85 a year and use the code Adam. All right, Dan Dunn is going to come in here, and we'll see what he's drinking right after this. Dan Dunn has joined us. He's a journalist. He's a spirit expert. And he's got a podcast, What We're Drinking with Dan Dunn, available wherever you get your podcast. And a hell of a writer. I've read his first book. Nothing to do with booze per se, or something to do with booze, but just a hell of a journalist. Dan Dunn, good to see you, Dan.
It has a little bit to do. It has to do with my tragic life that led me mm-hmm. to drinking. Yeah,
yes.
That's what it is. Yeah. How you doing, guys?
Good. We're all doing well. Yeah,
so cool to be back in the studio.
Yeah, what agreed.
A special moment this feels like to me. Yeah.
We should toast to it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right. Well, I brought some stuff. I mean, we've... you know, we've been doing this the last 13 months or so over Zoom, and that has some benefits to it, obviously, you know, pants and stuff like that. But so over the course of the last year, I figure we probably have had about 50 different liquors that we've tried.
I'll buy that.
About right.
And so in honor of getting back into the studio, back on with life, I thought, let me bring in 5 of the best spirits that we had during this whole quarantine that we enjoyed together over Zoom. 5 different spirits categories. So I have a gin, a tequila, a rum, a bourbon, and a scotch.
Ooh.
Okay?
Sweet.
We're going to rate these things. Okay. We're going to rate these spirits. We're going to declare a winner here. We'll call this a tournament of tippling. We're going to rate these things on, this is the following criteria we're going to use here. Taste, mixability, packaging, price, coolness factor. I'll throw out, so I'll give you some information, some tidbits. I'll tell you some stuff about the packaging and all that too. And on a scale of 1 to 5. So 25 is the maximum for each spirit.
Mm-hmm.
And there we go. That's how we're going to do this. All right. So you guys want to get right to the drinking?
Let's do it.
Is this what we're going to do? All right.
What's the definition of tippling?
Tipple is to drink, to tipple.
Yeah. Oh, it's to tipple.
Yeah.
Did not know that.
No, to tipple is to drink.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm always hesitant when someone comes up with something that's clever that no one gets. Because on one hand, it's still clever, but if no one gets it, tippling.
Tippling.
All right, tournament of tippling.
So first up, we're going to go with a gin. Mm-hmm. And this is a gin that is familiar to the crew here. We've got Ford's gin made by our friend Simon Ford. I'm going to pour myself
now,
a little bit.
Now, you got a dump cup, so don't dump. I hate when people waste anything. So just give a little splash there, Gina. Because the dump cup, I'm going to make Max Pat a drink that on his ride home.
The Harry Buffalo.
Commit to it.
So Ford's, of course, is made, is the product of our friend Simon Ford, who is the inventor of the Better Man cocktail.
Oh, yeah.
Made with Adam Carolla's very own Mangria. The gin itself is made by a 10th generation distiller whose family has been making gin since 1680. So now we're tasting this neat. We're not going to have it in any. That's how you have to do it. We're at room temperature. We're tasting it neat in a Glencairn glass, which is specially designed to taste. So we're going to get a little nose on here. Now, remember, gin is not a spirit that you're normally going to be drinking neat.
Right.
But in order to really evaluate the flavor, we got to do this. So.
But I tell you, gin is definitely one of those spirits you have to mature into.
Hmm.
As you get a little older, much like cigars and pussy, you start to, stuff that was yucky when you were 11.
Cancerous to the mouth.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You start to kind of get into it,
right.
You know, and at a certain point you go full Michael Douglas.
Well, gin is certainly, in terms of, you know, one of the categories we have here is mixability. I mean, gin is the foundation of so many great cocktails. Simon created this gin specifically so it tastes good in classic, like the gin and tonic, the martini, the Tom Collins, gimlets. Took this out to bartenders. got them to try it when they were in their development stages, mm-hmm. got them to try it with different cocktails, got notes from over 100 bartenders, and that's how they developed the flavor profile of this gin. Now, the packaging is one of the most user-friendly and functional bottles on the market. Brian's got it right there. It's lightweight, fits into a speed rail, holds onto the pourer snugly. And these are things that seem obvious, but you'd be shocked at how many bottles don't take that into account. There's no foil around the cap. It makes it really easy and to open quickly.
Oh, goddamn yeah. foil around the cap.
I
don't know if I sound like an alcoholic, but I find myself like getting out a penknife, like struggling. I had some wine the other day. They had the full wax dip. Mm-hmm. I fought it for like 20 minutes.
Carve it.
I'm gonna stab myself. And then at some point, all the chunks of wax, I sort of did it over the sink, you know, and then they're all into the sink, and it's a shit show. But yeah, there's a lot that have the shrink wrap, and I'm not sure where to start. You end up poking at it with the scissors.
Slice your hand open.
Yeah, this is nice.
The wax makes me, especially on wine, I mean, it really makes me crazy, because not only do you have to get the wax off it, then you got to pop the cork.
Yeah, now the work starts.
Yeah, what's going on?
And then you've got that weird jagged wax edge going around it. Okay.
So we got the mixability, the packaging we covered. The price on this is $25. That's what it costs for a bottle of this. Now, gin generally isn't you know, more expensive, like on the scale of whiskey or whatnot. So, and then in terms of coolness factor, like I said, I mean, Simon, guy who created a drink for Ace, 10th distiller, the guy's been, family's been making gin since 1680. And this is a top 10 brand in the top 50 bars in the world. So in the top 50 bars in the world, which is an actual thing, they release the list every year. This is one of the top 10 brands carried in those bars.
What I'm basing that on as a layperson is, for coolness factor, how cool would I feel bringing this bottle to a party? That's my way.
The mixability, we kind of have to guess at, obviously, although, Dan, it's a bit of a cheat for me because I love the Ford's gin. The bottle you gave us, you know, way back when, I mix it all the time. It's delicious.
Yeah, it's a great gin for any gin cocktail that you make, and there are more of them, I think, than most other cocktails, at least that I enjoy. So that's our Forge gin. And now, Ace, I'm going to dump this. I apologize. Oh, and I'm actually going to rinse my glass with a little water. Mm. I recommend you guys do that, too, just to get that gin out of there. And now we're going to dump
At least drink the fucking water. Jesus Christ, you just dumped the gin water
out. It's our most precious resource, Dan.
There are children.
We're in a drought.
Children going to bed sober in Africa. And look what I'm doing here. Okay, next up, we got a tequila.
I drank the gin water.
This is the 2020 Tequila Ocho Plata Rancho La Loma. Okay, Tequila Ocho, we had this on the show.
You're Mexican. Jesus Christ. That's the full name.
There you go, Gina.
Thank you.
There we go. This is a gin that we had on the show, I think, about 6 or 7 months ago.
This is tequila, sorry.
Tequila, yeah. They use overripe agave in this one, which is extremely unusual. It gives it a slight sweetness you won't notice when you're tasting other tequilas. I think that was something that Brian pointed out when we had this on the show before. You're going to get the grapefruit on here, the menthol pepper, very balanced, fruity, a really great gin. This is one of the tequilas that's committed the idea of terroir exists.
Yeah. Sometimes you're going between gin and tequila.
Gin. I keep saying gin.
That's tequila.
Just because I had gin. Tequila.
What's the alcohol on that's 40 and the first one was 40% content?
Oh. Yeah. So this is going to taste great in a margarita, a Paloma, a tequila old fashioned.
Technically, this is 90 proof, so it's 45%.
All right. Yeah. Okay.
Price on this is $45. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
This is the world's first single, if we're talking about coolness factor, this is the world's first single estate tequila. Each vintage is harvested. This is a 2020 vintage from a single field. Meaning vintage to vintage, you're going to get variations in the taste of the tequila, which is unusual. Most brands strive for uniformity in their taste.
Mm-hmm.
This was created by, I don't know if this is going to tip this at all, created by a legendary tequilero named Carlos Camarena and a guy named Tomas Estes, who just died.
I knew it.
A week ago. Yeah, just died a week ago. I don't know if that tilts it, but he passed away with his family last Sunday. This is a grower-producer tequila. That means the brand owns the agave fields. That's also unusual, from which they use to create this tequila. I love it.
It's very good. It's more of a sipping tequila, though. Would you mix this? Would you
mix
this?
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, one of the drinks that I was thinking about was the El Diablo, which is a highball with tequila, creme de cassis, and lime juice. Really, really good with this. Put a little ginger beer on top.
Delicious. I might still be thinking about the goat milk, but I'm almost finding something buttery in this.
Yeah. Yeah,
I love it. This would turn me, as my friends would say, this would turn me into tequila right quick. Yeah, this is delicious.
The texture on that is really good. And it's almost got a mezcal like feel to it, right? Okay, so we're getting our scores on this thing. Man, it's just, oh boy.
It's good.
All right. What do you think of the packaging?
Yeah.
All right.
I mean, it's
probably
not. It's
getting a little lower mark. And
it looks like a wine bottle, I think.
Yeah. And again, $45 is the price on that. And we're going to go there. Okay. Mm-hmm. Next up, we got to rinse our glasses here. We got some rum, a rum that we had on almost a year ago, I believe. And it's over here. There we go. We had this at Christmas. That's right. We did have this at Christmas. Dos Madeiros. Madeiros with an A. Dos Madeiros with an A. 5 and 3 is the name of this rum. Let me pour myself some. Pass it on over to you, Gina.
Mm-hmm.
There we go.
Don't pour
too much. You'll get in trouble. Okay. The taste on this, you get ripe fruit. You get some tropical spice, smoky oak, tobacco on the finish.
I remember this. This was really excellent.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm. We'll be the judge of that.
Mixability. You can do this with a Mai Tai. You could do it with an old-fashioned. Would be great for this rum, I think.
Oh, really? An old-fashioned? I didn't know you did rum in an old-fashioned.
Yeah, you could do it with that. We'd do it with sherry, banana liqueur. There's actually a recipe there, which I think would be delicious. You can do almost any spirit with an old-fashioned, really. Yeah, just swap them out.
That sounds so 50. I want like a wedge salad with that. It's so 50s sounding.
Yeah. I want this in my eggnog.
Yeah.
You know, for Christmas time. This is exactly
what we
what
we did? Did we do it with that?
We did one of them.
I think we did, familiar, but yeah, it all blurs together.
We were in a blackout.
Well, that was one of the nice things of the Zoom. You were like, we don't have to worry about anything. I just got to be able to get off this couch. The packaging, they recently changed the shape of the bottle for a more elegant look. It's sleeker. The label incorporates all the important elements. There's a map on that label.
Was the previous bottle squattier?
I think it was, yeah. I think it was a little bit smaller than that. And this, what's cool about this thing is this is a combo of rums sourced from Barbados and Guyana. The distillery, the R.L. Seal Distillery in Barbados, is 260 years old. It spends 5 years in bourbon casks. Then they, in the Caribbean, then they ship it over to Jerez, Spain, put it in ex-sherry casks for 3 more years of what's called Solera aging.
I'm just picturing your great-great-great-great-grandson, like, keeping this gig going and going, White Claw has been around for almost 300 years. It's canned in Van Nuys, single family, the Budweiser family. Well, they bought it. Because eventually everything's going to be old, right?
They're going to be Mangria. Boy, yeah. Hundreds of years ago when Mangria was invented.
This has almost no note to it. Like I'm trying to inhale it. And it's not really coming up. I mean, I don't know if is that a rum thing?
You mean the flavor on it?
I'm just doing the note. I'm trying to like
it's a little
suck it up.
I'm
not getting what I was getting out of the tequila and the gin. That's all I'm saying.
I mean, I'm certainly getting
I smell
getting
something.
On
no, I agree just with not
you. The
coming
gin
through.
Is more effervescent, right? Like it's in your nose and tequila too. But the
What was the price? Sorry,
the price on this one is
30.
30 bucks.
Yeah,
again, the aging I think is what makes it cool. 5 years in ex bourbon, 3 years in sherry, and the fact that they age it in Spain and the Caribbean. Are you guys normally rum drinkers?
Not
only
normally.
Since you've come around.
Okay. Ever since me. All right. Well, I'm ruining you. Okay. Next up, an old favorite here.
Rum has like. I grew up with like too many negative connotations. Like, he's an old rummy.
I've never heard
like,
that before.
Pirates drink rum.
Rummy?
Yeah, rummy.
Oh, yeah.
Gin rummy?
Like, they got the gin.
The wino,
blossoms,
yeah,
you know,
right.
Yeah, the drunk on the corner.
Oh, that's funny.
Though you'd be an old rummy, and then pirates drink rum, and it seemed a little dangerous.
I thought where you were going with that, our connotation from college is, I'll have a rum and Coke. Rum and DC.
Yeah.
Captain Morgan's.
Last time you guys drank this with a ginger beer.
delicious.
Mm. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
My grandmother used to say when people were drunk, she would say they're rum soaked.
Ooh, oh, right.
Good. That guy's rum soaked.
I like that.
You know, the Italian grandfather, a lot of tiramisu with rum in it.
Yeah. Yeah.
She said other things. She said other things too, my old grandma from Philadelphia, and we won't discuss those on the air. Okay. Next up, we got some bourbon, Rabbit Hole High Gold Bourbon. I don't remember when we had this on the show, but I do recall everybody really enjoying it. And I'm going to pass this over to you, Gina. You got it. Now, this one definitely, I think you're going to get some stuff on the nose here, Adam. I'm getting coconut and some like soft spices.
Oh, this is on my bar.
Rabbit Hole.
It's a sharp looking
rabbit
bottle.
It's a beautiful bottle. Yeah. Ooh, heavy pour, bartender.
So they don't chill. They don't chill filter this. We've talked about chill filtering before, which is where they try to remove, you know, sort of stuff out of the. Uh-huh. It's basically a cosmetic procedure, but they don't chill filter this. And I think that's what really gives this that silky mouthfeel. Mm. You getting that? Yeah.
Wow.
That is delicious.
Butterscotch, black pepper.
Now we're cooking with gas.
Cave Zamanian is the guy who makes it. He personally makes this mash bill. And this is there's a high concentration. As we know in bourbon, it has to be at least 51% corn in the mash bill. But then he has a very high rye amount in the mash bill as well. I believe it's 25% rye, which is high. And then 70% corn, 25 rye, 5 malted barley. This is 95 ABV.
Would you mix this?
Absolutely.
It tastes so smooth by itself.
It has that coconut vibe.
It's fantastic in a gold rush. You know, the gold rush, lemon juice and honey. I mean, this is made, or a Kentucky mule, which is lime juice and ginger beer, the high gold. You do a pineapple sour with this. But, of course, all your classics, too. The Sazerac, the old fashioned, the Manhattan. Rye bourbon in a Manhattan, because you can do bourbon or rye in a Manhattan. But rye bourbon, it's so great for that. A bourbon with a high rye in the mash bill is really great in Manhattan.
Mm. And it's my favorite so far.
This is really good stuff.
I actually give it a 6 on taste.
Price is what are we talking about here?
$70.
$70.
But it tastes and feels like $70.
It's a $70 liquor.
Yeah.
Delicious.
It is good.
And what do you think of the package there?
Very cool.
Nice.
Yeah, it's got a very satisfying pop sound when you pull that cork out of it. I always like that. It feels great in your hand when you pour it. Very stunning presentation. High Gold, by the way, was named after Christian High Gold, who was a German immigrant to Louisville in the 1850s. And it's a nod to the Germans were the one that basically bought the malted rye component to this. So, all right.
I like the etched rabbit. That's a nice little touch.
Yeah.
A little subtle touch right there.
And all right. So, that's good.
Mm.
Blowing through this stuff. I like contests. All right, next up, our final in our top 5 in the Tournament of Tippling. To tipple is to drink, Gina.
I love
it. You know that? I learned that recently.
I know that now.
We got Glen Grant's 18-year-old single malt scotch. You guys remember this one?
No.
Unapologetically expensive.
That never came to our house. I would know that.
You didn't get this. This is $135 a bottle. Now, of course, when we're factoring in the price, you have to understand this is an 18-year-old single malt scotch. The master distiller, Dennis Malcolm, is a legend. He was born on the distillery grounds. He began his career at Glen Grant 60 years ago. He is the longest serving distiller in Scotland, the guy who makes this. The entire production of this whiskey, from barley to milling to bottling, happens at the distillery. Too much for you?
Really put some hair on my chest.
Yeah, well, it's a...
Prove it. Gina, I'm being serious. This never showed
No, that does
my
not
house.
Look familiar.
Okay, I was going to say, though, never had this.
Yeah, this has a little bit of a finish that comes back through your nostrils.
Yeah,
a little wasabi vibe.
Yeah, that's what it is. Like you bite in a wasabi, and then it kind of comes, the vapors come up through your nose.
This is a substantial whiskey. I mean, there's no denying that. I mean, I really like the look of that bottle, too. It's got that modern Victorian look going on. The scotch itself, you get raisins, vanilla, pear, apples. I'm getting toasted almond on here.
Wow.
This isn't a scotch that I would necessarily think you're going to make a lot of drinks with, but if you wanted to, you could do a scotch and soda with that, or a Rob Roy, which is just the scotch, vermouth, and Angostura bitters, you know, which is delicious. It's a Speyside whiskey. That's the section of Scotland that produces the most famous scotches, probably. And it's really good. I mean, I just love this whiskey.
I think it's for whiskey lovers. It's kind of weird I find a weird aftertaste to it, but maybe that's what whiskery lovers would like about it.
Really? What do you mean by the weird aftertaste?
What do you get? Mossy? Peaty?
It's just, it's like real guys who love cigars. They want like some strong Honduras cigars. They don't want like light cigars.
Or like
cigars.
Right. Super beer nerds want like, you know, the Saison, the super sour.
It's
better.
Like this is for hardcore
people that,
guys.
Yeah, you're not, this isn't going to be for a neophyte. You're not going to start with this.
Right. And remember, every 99% of the time we've had drinks on this show, we've opened it up with a couple of drops of water or put an ice cube. Mm. So everything's going to feel stronger.
So this is the kind of thing that 80% of the population wouldn't like as much as the rabbit hole, but then 20% would like it more because, but a seasoned hardcore.
Well, let me ask you this: when people come over, when you're entertaining,
mm-hmm.
do your guests generally, if they're drinking liquor, would mm-hmm. Do people generally gravitate towards scotch, or are you serving more lighter spirits?
I think everyone's drinking vodka these days. Like they're just putting vodka in. So I think because of the whole kind of dietary, whatever people are doing, like they're taking the spiked seltzer and they're dumping some vodka mm-hmm. and some ice in it, and you know that kind of stuff.
And tequila, I think right now might be the hottest. Agave, mezcal and tequila probably the biggest growth out there. In
anecdotally,
terms of
I'd agree.
And I, you know, with the tequila, I mean, when it starts getting warm, and we live here in Southern California, there's nothing quite like, you know, you can make it. I make margaritas all the time. I make that with the Ocho, actually, where you just, limes are everywhere out here, and you get some, and just get some agave syrup, and that's it. It's all you need. And
well,
it's
I think the story is everyone's drinking everything, which is to say, you know, you take these, you know, when I was younger, people drank tequila to get fucked up at the park, you know. Nobody drank gin. Nobody knew what rye was unless they were listening to American Pie, the song. And even then, we didn't really know what it was. Like, it was pretty much vodka and beer. And it was like, and then, you know, you want a burger, you go to McDonald's. So it's everything is getting spread out and all this niche everything, which is good. Like, this is the pageantry of life.
Definitely.
That song drives me crazy, by the way, because he says, good old boys were drinking whiskey and rye.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Rye is whiskey.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Get it right, man. And speaking of gin, by the way, you brought up gin. This is kind of incredible. You know who's guesting on my show soon?
Who?
Snoop.
Oh.
Clearly did not.
In Duggo.
Clearly did not hear the segment. Because I was telling people, I go, of all the things that we've had on this show over the years I've been coming in, I don't know that anything caused such a visceral reaction, you know, negative reaction than in Indigo.
It's a cultural thing. It'd be like us smoking menthol cigarettes and enjoying them. It's a cultural thing, number one. Number two, I had a bottle of Snoop's red wine the other day, and it was delightful.
Really?
Snoop's got a red wine.
Yeah, it's about $19 a bottle, right? It's pretty cheap.
It was good.
What's it called? Wizzy?
It was
19 Crimes.
What is it?
19 Crimes. Crimes?
19 Crimes. Yeah, it's Snoop Dogg wine. It's a Snoop Cali Red.
It was good?
Wow. And it was good?
So you can tell him that. And tell him his main man, Mayonnaise, said hi. That's my rap handle. Because it's white, you know what I mean?
Call it
Mayonnaise with a Z? Yeah, come on.
That's good. Mm-hmm. Call it basic. Call it ignorant. I don't like this.
It's whiskey.
It's not for me. I'm not enough of a whiskey.
It's pretty hardcore.
Aficionado to appreciate this, let's just say.
Yeah, but I thought you liked it when we had it before. Maybe we were.
I swear to you, I've never had this.
But remember, like I said, we had it with ice in it, or we had it with water in it. This is very potent.
This is sort of like if you're into seafood, you might be into octopus, if you're kind of a fish and chips guy, that's your seafood. Yeah. Then this is a little dramatic. Like this is advanced. Throw it away.
How much does it really bother you when we dump stuff? Does it really upset you?
I need a
glass back.
Listen, I think we're done.
Brian's not there in front of him.
I told. Let's see. Yeah, I don't like wasting anything. It's booze, it's plastic, it's food, it's whatever. Here's me. My daughter will make avocado toast for breakfast, mm-hmm. right? She has some sort of technique where she carves out half an avocado, spreads half of the half on the avocado, and then the other half is on a paper plate where there's just smeared avocado on the paper plate. And I know at 8:30 in the morning, if I open the trash can, there's going to be a plate with half a half, a quarter of an avocado on top. Ugh. I'll pull it out and eat it, or I'll feed it to Phil.
Right out of the trash.
Right out of the trash.
Good for you.
It's a Seinfeld episode.
Sitting on the top of the trash.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I do
Who
not.
Who eats avocado?
Wait, if it's sitting outrageous. On top of the trash, it's touching the lid.
No, it's just, it's one of those drawer types.
Sorry, Gina.
Open
air. Your freezer at the top of the fridge.
I found one that was 2 days old in there, and I gave that to Phil.
Right.
And then I kept the fresh one for myself.
Adam, your trash has a lid on it.
And a step pedal.
Yeah. It's built in. But I don't waste anything.
I'm like you, man. During quarantine, you know, especially towards the end, we were all getting back. I've had friends over, and I have a lot of alcohol at my house, and sometimes I'll get just this much left, right? Just a tiny bit. And if it's, let's just say it's tequila, it's not even enough for a drink. So I will take that one and pour that in, and then take another bottle because I don't want to just throw it. It's like it's not even enough for a drink, right? I can't throw it out.
Wait, so you kiss the ketchup? What do you? Oh, you just
I'll
drink
marry
it.
Them.
I'll pour that and marry it with another another gin or another, whatever. Yeah.
The greatest adult tip I ever got was from Olga the nanny, who I would buy the glass bottles with the cream, the heavy whipping cream, and the little glass bottle.
Do that with every bottle of cream.
And she said when you're done with it, just dump a little hot coffee in it, snap the lid back on, and shake it all up. Gets the cream at the top to loosen up and come down. Gets all, and then just dump
it
in your mug.
All the time.
I do too. Satisfying.
Isn't growing up poor great? Just think about big kids that grew up rich. They're like, this cream.
But there's a market for it now because they're life hacks for like the mommy bloggers and they're life hacks.
What
are you talking about?
Nothing to do with money. It's just a weird thing. Yeah. It's whenever I play a theater before I go on stage, I shut all the lights off in the green room, in the dressing room. Shut them all off because I'm going to be on stage for 90 minutes. No one's going to be in here.
You're acting like Mr. Wiltern over here.
Yep, that's how.
What about bottles? Because we have had, looking at the Ford's bottle, for instance. What about when you get a really cool-looking bottle? Does that bother you to throw that out when it's done? Like, do you feel like you want to keep it for another reason?
Aesthetic.
No, because that is a monument to your alcoholism. You know what I mean? It's
keeping
like
the bottles.
Every prostitute you've murdered, you're going to keep her panties hanging from your rear view.
I don't think so.
First off, you wouldn't be able to see through the windshield. Secondly, every time you got in a car, it'd be a sobering reminder of what you did at night.
Dan,
there's
myriad
problems.
Yeah.
Myriad
All right. problems. You're like, man, he's got a lot of flower arrangements going on here and bottles of alcohol.
Yeah.
I've thought about doing that before because there's that, remember the Clas Azul bottle, the tequila bottle that it's blue and white.
Right.
Oh yeah, the tall
tequila. Like that's hard to throw that one out.
I have Crystal Skull vodka that's never been opened. It's just so cool to look at.
Yeah, that's a great Dan Aykroyd's spot.
Yeah, I never tasted it. It's got the seal on it.
Yeah, that's a good bottle. I can't throw that at you. I have a bunch of those at the house, the skulls.
Is it good?
It's good vodka, yeah. And you got to get him on the show, man. He's an amazing guy. Like I've had him on my show, and he very passionate about that vodka.
Let's do it.
Very passionate. And they've had a lot of offers to buy him out. Doesn't want to do it. Wants to own the brand. You know.
Wow.
I mean,
he's. I don't know if he's probably my favorite SNL guy, just because.
Ever.
Wow. Well, I kind of grew up with him.
No, it's a great choice.
And
it's
always loved his precision. Mm-hmm. Like when he was doing the
Irwin Mainway.
Yeah, but just
Bag of glass.
But he was great with that, but just his little stuff, like when he would do the swinging Czech brothers.
The Fest Drunk Brothers.
His accent was so much better than Steve Martin. Steve Martin was doing an over-the-top kind of weird caricature, goofy. Yeah. He was doing an accent. Like, he was doing
like
something.
He's a technician.
Yeah, he's a technician. I always thought, or even when he'd be doing the, bass-o-matic or something like that, he was a technician.
All you need to know is how great he was in Trading Places. He went completely square and was nailed it. It was perfect.
His timing, I mean, probably the best delivery was the Jane, you ignorant slut.
Right.
Just the way he delivers that line. And the other one that I love is the Bass-O-Matic 76.
Yes.
That was real, by the way. I talked to him about it. That was a real bass.
You couldn't fake it. He dropped it right in.
He dropped it in. He did it, and then he drank it.
Yeah.
I was like, wow. Mm. Put the whole bass. So
all right.
Should we give you our scorecards?
We should get you our scorecards. We should write our names on it, right?
Total them up for me because you know I'm not good. I'm not smart.
Totaled.
Total of wait.
Each just
each,
each,
yeah,
each
I, spot. Yeah, I did it as I went. All right, let me tell you about 1-800-Flowers.com. Attention, last minute Mother's Day shoppers. There's still time. To be mom's favorite, but you got to hurry to 1-800-Flowers.com. 1-800-Flowers has you covered with amazing deals on Mother's Day gifts from bouquets and plants and even gourmet treats as well. I'd recommend a bouquet. They sent one over here. I told you, it's been a couple weeks. It's still going strong. Beautiful roses. And whether it's roses, lilies, daisies, all blooms from 1-800-Flowers are picked at their peak and available for same-day delivery to ensure freshness. So let's get going. Remember, Mother's Day deals are going to they're going to end soon. So let's order today, right, Dawson?
Remember, Mother's Day is this Sunday, so take care of all your gifting needs with 1-800-Flowers.com. To order last-minute Mother's Day bouquets, arrangements, and gifts, go to 1-800-Flowers.com, click the radio icon, and enter code ADAM. That's 1-800-Flowers.com, code ADAM.
Dan is living out an actual nightmare of mine, having to do math quickly.
The problem with this segment is now coming out. I can't add, and I'm, so Chris is going to do it.
Yeah. All right.
News.
All right. We'll take a break. We'll come back. We'll do the news, and we'll give you the winner right after this.
Give me the news with Grad. News with Gina Grad. Break. Viral, weird crime, protest, politics. Give me news with Gina Grad. Stuff they saw on TMZ. Joe Biden, Kamala. Beat news with Gina Grad.
The news with Gina Grad.
Well, some really horrific news. While we're drinking.
Dan is approaching the bar.
He sure is. At least 45 people were killed and more than 150 were injured in a stampede at a religious festival in northern Israel. And I have the video from it. So medical officials said this on Friday. It was one of the country's deadliest civilian disasters. It's just thousands of men pushing, and it's like a sea back and forth. It's just
45 people killed.
Yeah. So the stampede occurred during the celebration of Lag BaOmer at Mount Meron. That's the resting place of a second century sage and mystic, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. This is a Kabbalah thing. I didn't really grow up with Lag BaOmer, but it's a little more religious. So each year, tens of thousands of people, mostly ultra Orthodox Jews, gather to celebrate the rabbi and traditionally light these bonfires. And what we just looked at was literally people spilling down this open-air corridor amid what appeared to be this cacophony of sounds and alarm sounds and people getting carried with the crowd.
Yeah, you have to think about 45 souls in a place that's like 1/50th the size of the United States.
Yeah.
You know, it's a percentage thing. Like it's a big deal. I wonder if any bulls want to run with them. Like turnabout is fair play.
Oh, wow. Well.
A couple bulls.
It's our turn.
We're in red scarves. Decided to get in on the action.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't know. Religious
it's
stampedes
weird.
Is
it's,
weird.
It's weird.
Yes.
And like I said, I mean, we certainly didn't grow up with that. But, you know, it's like any super fundamentalist or super religious, whatever they're doing, it's not something the rest of us can
Does
relate to.
Does this happen annually or regularly, I guess?
I think it happens annually.
That's crazy.
To pay the respect to this rabbi, and then it's a pilgrimage.
But this surge of humanity.
I mean, Lag BaOmer happens every year.
Wow.
We haven't had one around here for a while. We had that Who concert a million
AC/DC
years ago.
Concert, yeah.
Oh, right.
Oh, there's an AC/DC one?
People got trampled at an AC/DC concert back in the 90s.
Well, that soccer game, that was the worst one over in England where they
crammed
everybody in. 100 people died. Got crushed to death. It's a great documentary, the 30 by 30 about it. But basically just kept letting people in.
Yeah.
And everybody was put in. Everybody just kept pushing, pushing, and literally killed 100 people. Got crushed to death inside a soccer stadium.
It's kind of a weird modern day death. You know what I mean? It's the kind of thing you think we would have worked out 40 years ago.
Well,
what with all the technology,
but think about
it's just like wristbands and hand stamps and temperature checks.
Common courtesy.
Maybe the vaccine passport, yeah, you know, things that just slow the...
Every year this happens at the doorbuster deals on Thanksgiving night.
Mm-hmm.
And people don't die, but people do get trampled at those, you know, Target, Kmart, Walmart.
Are the deals that good?
They're doorbusters.
What does that mean? I don't even know.
Definitely
what
not a Jew.
Great. I have no idea.
Like, I think you should stay away from all things that are potential trampling situations.
Agreed.
Now, look, if you want to go to the soccer game, fine. Go to the fucking skybox.
Yeah.
What are you talking?
Well, I told you guys, I was in high school, I was at a Kiss concert. Of course I was. And I was in the front row, and people started pushing. Mm-hmm. And I was like, literally, like, I was stuck. And this security guard pulled me out by my belt buckle. I was much thinner then.
Mm-hmm.
And literally pulled me out by my belt buckle because I was getting crushed against the bars.
Yeah,
it's crazy. No. Well, I went to the Capitol in January, and should I not be
you
home?
You said too much.
Shouldn't mention. Sorry. Friends.
Gina, I'm guessing the answer is no for you. Adam, probably no. Dan, or anyone. Have you ever charged the field at a sporting event?
No.
Gina, I know.
You mean like...
like the team won, the and we're rushing the field.
No.
I don't mean like a streaker situation.
No, I just mean like that's a college football kind of move right there.
I did that 99 at USC when they beat UCLA.
I'm surprised more people aren't injured by goalposts because when they get them, first off,
those are deadly.
You have all the people hanging on them, like up top, like we got to take the goalpost down, and then you have everyone underneath who could be struck by goalposts.
Seems dangerous.
Yeah,
I just think the thing that freaks me out is golf because there's a level of trust.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe because I'm not that great at golf, but when people line up and
gallery.
Those guys hit that drive,
yes, you're asking
all
a lot.
I think to myself is, what if, just what if Bryson DeChambeau just is having an off day and he hits that 200-mile-an-hour drive.
Well, what if he gets stung by a bee in the nape of the neck, like right as he's going forward, and just shanks it?
You're dead. You would be dead, instantly
like
dead.
A baseball will kill you, and a golf ball will put a hole in you. If one of those guys got the big berth up there, and you were standing 20 feet away, and he just completely shanked it. It's a weird one.
Well, I think golf fans are weird in general. I was watching golf over the weekend, and I think it's funny when they shank the ball, though, like on their drive, and the people that run to the ball, they don't work there. They're not part of the tournament, and they all run to the ball and put their hands out.
It's a golf ball.
Right.
Don't touch it. It could go off any minute. You know, like, and it's like, who are these people?
Well, two things.
Relax.
I still want to be the guy who screams, get in the hole, after the 22-foot putt that Tiger Woods does, like 10 inches after it leaves his putter. Get in the hole! Like, I want to be that guy. Once. Yeah. And the ultimate in ballsy fans.
Shit, yeah!
European rally fans. The guy is the guy's in a fucking fire-breathing turbocharged Audi Quattro whatever, and he's sideways coming around the corner in Scotland, and you're standing there. There's no barrier. There's no cement. No, you're just standing in the middle of a field, and it's fucking raining, and there's mud all over the windshield, and the guy's got the windshield going. He just caught air 10 seconds ago coming over the hill, and now he's completely sideways. And he's got his foot flat out, like the car's just drifting and all tires are being. And you're standing on the outside of the curb, just standing there.
Leaning in, trying to get high five.
What's the race at Isle of Man?
Isle of Man.
I watched a documentary on that. And there are people right on the side of the road. And these guys, they're going, why do you care? Like, Jesus Christ, it's so nuts. Like, who would want to die? Imagine if you die. That's how you die.
Yeah.
You go to watch like a race. Yeah. And you get killed because you weren't content to sit in the fucking stands.
Well, they had, you know, Lamar had 80 people die in the stands in like 1955 with like Mercedes.
Well, didn't the tires used to come off too in the NASCAR
races? That's final destination. That's final destination.
Was it NASCAR? The tires would fly off and hit people?
They had Ferrari got brought up on manslaughter charges because a bunch of people died during the Mia Miglia. The Italian road race thing. The Italian road race one is they'd go right through the center of town on cobblestone at 110 miles an hour, and people be sitting on the sidewalk like drinking a coffee as they went by. We used to have a different relationship with death.
Oh my God! Well, remember hockey when we were like hockey didn't have the nets behind the. It was just the glass. Yeah, like you know these guys are you know Brett Hull's hitting 150 mile an hour slap shots, and sometimes they would go in the stand. It took a little girl got killed. That's Jesus. When they finally went. You know what? Maybe we should put some nets up here since
starting
this
to think
thing.
About
yeah.
it.
Back then it was you know. Just didn't care.
The goalie didn't have a mask. The goalie was, he's like, I can't wear a mask. I smoked during the game. He's like, that was probably the original argument for no mask. How am I going to smoke? I got to stand here for 2.5 hours in a frozen pond I can't light up?
It was a special time.
It was a special time.
Jarts. Remember jarts? Remember that? I was just talking about this the other day. Remember the... They were lawn darts?
Lawn darts. Yeah.
Oh. This was an actual product that they sold... Yep. Ostensibly for children.
Yes,
heavily weighted darts that you give to kids and let them throw them.
That's true because a famous grad family story, since my dad was the oldest of five, one of those getting stuck in my uncle's chest. Mm-hmm. Because they were whipping them at each other. It was 50s Chicago. That was good, clean fun.
Did he get...
I don't even think he went to the hospital. But he was like, "What, guys? What?"
We have
he didn't see it.
Sorry, we have the scores ready.
Oh, okay, you guys ready? So, should I just declare the winner?
We started up from fifth to first.
Yeah, okay,
work the drama, Dan.
Yeah.
Okay, coming in at number five, probably because Brian seemed to want to torpedo this brand with his scores.
I didn't enjoy
He brought it down. I'm just going to say he brought it down a little bit. Was the Glen Grant 18-year-old single malt scotch was our number five.
Well, I think at $120 a pop.
Yeah, $135.
That was probably part
of
it.
We're not man enough for it.
And again, I'm qualifying this by saying it comes in fifth, but it's one of the best things that we had.
Ready to appreciate it.
Coming in at, we had a tie so I guess would that be four or three?
Three and four.
I don't know. I'm so bad at math. We had a tie between the Dos Madeiras 5+3 rum, double aged rum, and the 2020 Tequila Ocho Plata Rancho Loma tie.
All right.
Now, if I say number two, that's going to give it away. So I'll just say the winner. Can I get a drum roll? Can I ask for that? After all, I've been on the show enough.
I didn't get a lot out of that rum. I got to tell you,
The winner, the first annual Carolla Show Tournament of Tippling, is Rabbit Hole High Gold Bourbon.
With an average
score of 23.25 out of 25. I mean, almost swept it. And then obviously coming in in second was Forge Gin. Simon Ford will no longer be making cocktails for Adam.
Well,
after this.
Forge Gin for $25 a bottle, you're not gonna beat that. I just happen to like the bourbon.
The rabbit hole.
That rabbit hole
my
six awesome.
For taste on the bourbon.
Well, also, bourbon's meant to be consumed as we're consuming it. The gin, you don't just pour just room temperature into a glass and drink it. I wouldn't say it's unfair, but it's made for mixing and ice and everything else.
It's a great choice. It's delicious. I hate to break it to you. I think next time we're going to do the worst spirits we've ever had.
Oh, that'll be fun.
Tell Snoop.
I mean, was there any besides the Snoop that we... I'm trying to remember if there were any that really... I remember we did a wine segment and you called...
Prosecco or some shit.
You called it the Coors Light of wines.
You made the mistake of bringing Prosecco into these hollowed grounds.
Yeah, it was bad. I apologize.
I hope you only realize it.
Yeah, when you don't like something, there's no subtlety in your. Yeah.
Don't get him started on race. Go ahead, Gina.
All right,
that's far off there.
Josh Duggar, that name sound familiar with
the Duggar family?
19 kids and counting. He has been charged. Receiving and possessing child pornography following his arrest by federal agents in Arkansas.
I would argue, I mean, not that he was charged with this, but like if he molested three of his kids, if you have 19 kids, that's a pretty good
ratio.
That's a solid ratio.
I'm glad you brought that up my postscript to this story. Let's just skip right to the end.
No.
Duggar co-starred with his large family from 2008 to 2015. However, that show was canceled after Josh was accused of having molested his underage girls, his sisters, including several of his sisters when he was a teenager more than 10 years earlier. He admitted to having done so and apologized, explaining that he'd since spoken to authorities and received counseling. So he molested his sisters.
Are they weird? Do they? I mean, that weird religion going on with them?
I think they lean.
Gotta be something,
I think they lean,
right?
Christian.
No, I think he just Duggar.
Oh,
get it?
Oh, you did it. So he's been charged by indictment with receiving and possessing child porn, one count each. If convicted, he faces up to 20 years in prison and fines of $250,000 for each count.
How do they know, though? Like, I mean, I'm just curious. Did someone turn him in? Are they? How do they know? I'm asking for a friend.
So
obviously, yeah. But
I don't think or claim to know if this particular corporation was involved in this. But let us not forget, from To Catch a Predator, the company that helped solve these crimes was called Perverted Justice. Mm-hmm. So there are companies like that will help facilitate, you know, grabbing these things off the dark web. I have no idea.
Well, shouldn't there be some sort of an algorithm, I would assume, on the internet where if someone is downloading child pornography, it raises a flag somewhere?
I would imagine it does.
I think that's out there. I think we need to start implementing that thing where they say, like, before you send that tweet, just wait 20 minutes. Mm-hmm. And then if you still think, but you're probably not going to think it was a good idea. Everyone needs to beat off before they go trolling for porn. Like, you just got to just knock one out. Oh. Yeah. Just squeeze one off. Yeah. Take a little of the wind out of the sail.
Wait, are you saying we're supposed to eat before we go to dinner?
Yeah, I'm saying.
I'm not sure I understand that.
What I'm saying is, if I watch the porn, if you think,
then why am I watching the porn after?
If you think it's a good idea to go on the internet or the dark web, mm-hmm. or someplace like that, and you go, I'm going to start looking for some child porn.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
go in the bathroom, toss one out, and come back out and see if that's if you still think it's a good idea.
Right.
That's all.
If you think it's a good idea, I think you need to take one for the team and go in the bathroom with a gun. You know, if you're thinking about children and sex. But in terms of, I mean, I watch normal porn, but I don't jerk off before I watch it.
You know, no.
Maybe they have cuddle porn. Do they have cuddle porn? Like, you jerk off and then you watch.
Oh, like spooning?
You can cuddle afterwards.
No, but that's a category.
It's a good idea.
I think that's what Hallmark Channel is for.
Is it?
I think that's what they do.
My thoughts on porn are always this. I don't think the women who are in the porn get to decide what category they're in.
Oh, yeah.
But at some point, they got to look themselves up.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And it's like hefty MILF and they thought it was busty nubile.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, they presented it as
real,
like, young and busty.
Real look in the mirror.
Because the category don't lie. You know, they will tell you at Pornhub. They will let you know what category you are in. And there's, like, plumpers and milfers and, like, you know.
It says plumpers?
Probably.
Wow.
I'm saying
I wouldn't know if to ask the Duggars.
There's a lot of stepmom and, you know, there's old and there's fat. Mm. And you may think you're in busty, but you may be in fat.
Right, and
that's
chubby.
That's all I'm saying. Yeah, they will tell, that category will tell you.
I have a friend speaks volumes about the type of people I hang out with, who said her friend wanted to get in porn, mm-hmm. and so reached out to me because obviously, right, I know porn, and said, can you help her? I actually do know somebody in the porn business, and this friend of hers is 25 years old. And when I reached out to the friend, I sent him the pictures, and he said, she's too old, 25. There's no in-between. There are young girls, and then there are the famous porn stars that age into MILF territory, but the 25 to 35 area,
no man's
there's
land.
Not enough demand for those women. So
it's already washed
that,
up.
That probably tells you a lot about
what's
going
like
on porn
cars. Wise. There's new cars and there's vintage cars. No one wants a car from 1992.
Yeah.
Or
exactly.
A girl.
Want a Dodge Stealth from 1992? No, thank you. Yeah, that's what it is.
That's a great point.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm. Let's talk a little more Armie Hammer.
Shit, yeah!
So One of his family members is set to provide details about the high-profile family in an upcoming limited docuseries. This is according to Fox News.
His brother Navy's piping up.
Casey Hammer.
Ah, shit.
Yeah. She.
Brother
speaking of porn stars, Casey Hammer.
She is the granddaughter of Armand Hammer and Armie's aunt. She's reportedly signed an exclusive deal with Talos Films through the production. They haven't found a home yet, but she signed the deal. The co-founders describe it like this. The Hammer family history is like Succession on steroids, Brian.
Oh, come on.
A dysfunctional dynasty with its male characters exhibiting all the devastating consequences of privilege gone wild, Brian. Now, for the first time, Casey Hammer will tell not just her story, but the definitive family history, leaving no stone unturned. With new unfolding revelations and present-day consequences, this miniseries will provide audiences with a riveting journey into a family where reputation is everything and where things are never how they appear.
All right, well, take this in the spirit in which it's intended. If you sat my sister down and said, tell me 10 things about Adam, 11 of them would be a lie. Like, you should be wrong about everything. Every story, every recollection, ever. This one time he said during Thanksgiving, it would all be wrong. And she's not even lying. That's just how
what
it
she
works.
She remembers.
That's just, chicks don't remember things as they were. They remember things as how it made them feel. So everything is how I felt during this time, which is never an accurate way of describing this. She's going to be off about everything. It's all going to be horrible.
Would you be angry if your sister...
Armie Hammer's past more accurately than his fucking aunt could. I guarantee you. And I've never met the man. I met him once at Kimmel, and I just walked up to him and he was in his dressing room, and I said, hey, tell your brother he was awesome in Social Network.
That's funny.
That was it.
By the way, Casey Hammer has a book called Surviving My Birthright. So she's really milking this thing.
She's really going for it.
Yeah.
It's none of it. None of it's going to be. You can't trust any of it.
Oh. Family's great, aren't they? You know?
Oh, they're the worst.
When you get famous, I mean, do you think really famous people sit back and try to identify which family member's going to betray them ultimately? You know, it's like, who's going to sell me out?
It only takes one book deal for them to throw the entire family or one, you know, special or one discovery miniseries for them to just completely destroy the entire family.
Yeah.
It's all it takes.
Boy, I'm looking at the first couple pages and she is really... She's still setting the scene with her cold driveway and flapping curtains. So I don't know where this is going.
My grandmother talked about what a piece of shit I was into a camera
while
I was alive and doing fine. Like, all I did was become successful and get on the cable.
And she bring
was
her cake.
Talking shit. I brought her fucking cake and she was talking shit about me. I mean, imagine if I'd eaten someone's rib or molested somebody or something.
Yeah.
Well, let's talk a little Elon Musk on SNL. This is confusing. I would love your help.
Is he coming on or did he do it?
No,
he's
next host. Next this coming Saturday.
Yeah, this he's yeah. coming on yeah. this. He's coming on to host. Saturday,
correct.
This
so SNL cast members won't be forced to appear alongside him.
Is he that controversial?
They're calling him the controversial billionaire, according to Page Six. So confusing.
What are his stances
okay.
that are so inflammatory?
So let's just go through some of this because, again, it's very unclear. So,
like, fuck woke comedians. Like, just fucking go tell your jokes.
Well, apparently he tweeted, like, let's find out how live Saturday Night Live really is. And cast member Bowen Yang wrote, what the fuck does this even mean? Writer Andrew Demiscus.
There's this whole thing where it's like, we have to declare war on all successful people because he's a billionaire and he's whatever. Fuck that kid. Like, I saw that too. It's like, you're 26, dude. You're lucky to be on SNL.
Yeah.
It's probably a little higher, a little ethnically hired, you know what I mean? Yeah. Well, I mean, you have to have a diverse cast now.
Have they ever had an Asian cast member before now? I don't think so.
But why are you talking shit about the upcoming host?
Steve Forbes has hosted. Donald Trump has hosted. I remember Andrew Dice Clay back in the day.
That was Nora Dunn. And guess what happened to Nora Dunn?
Didn't stick
Dunn.
Around.
Dunn. Next season.
That's right.
Did not get ass back.
See you, Nora.
That's good.
Thank you.
So Andrew...
I got that from Con Air.
That was real good. Said, the only CEO I want to do a sketch with is Sherry O'Terry. Is she a CEO? CEO? Okay. No, and right. A.D. Bryant retweeted.
Oh, is she about her initials?
Yeah, I think it was
genius, Brian. Yeah. Well done.
Clever. Still got it.
A.D. Bryant retweeted a post by Bernie Sanders, and they're linking these together saying,
Let me hold on.
Yeah.
No, go ahead and read to me. Then
it
I'm
is a
fucking
moral
launch.
Obscenity that the 50 wealthiest people in America today own more wealth than the bottom half of our people.
Well, first off, fuck you very much for being a genius. Like, sorry. He's a fucking genius. He's putting people on Mars. He's creating an electric car that's affordable for the fucking masses and saving you with all the global warming and everything. So first things first, you can't please any of these assholes. You cannot please them. This guy's revolutionized the electric car world. Maybe the I would argue that if you did a polling of SNL cast members, I would say the environment is probably their number one cause.
Top.
He's impacting that in a super positive way, and it's like, fuck him, he's making money.
By any measure, he's an international celebrity. I'd be interested to see like the last 12 hosts, for example.
But
he's
also
probably more famous than any of them.
You fucking dickheads are going to do with SNL what they already did with the Oscars. You're going to fucking woke yourselves
hostless.
Right into hostless and no fucking ratings because you can't shut your fucking holes.
Yeah.
Do the fucking comedy. Get the fuck off the stage. That's the job. We don't need to hear about Bernie Sanders. We don't need to hear about it. Yeah.
Well,
we don't need to know all
he's
this.
He's not the only one catching the flack because how could it go any other way? Miley Cyrus being blasted for signing up to perform when Musk's episode appears.
And by the way, when did all this shit become like supporting? You know, you've supported.
But
like, look, they could have had anybody host on that night, and then she would be the musical guest. Yeah. Why is this an endorsement of everything
I
all
don't
the
know.
Time?
But please help me understand this, too, and maybe Chris or somebody knows what this means. That some fans claimed online that Elon Musk, to shit on the point you just made, is destroying the planet and that he doesn't like women. Where has this headline been?
I don't.
Why doesn't he? What do you mean he doesn't like women? By the
way,
I haven't seen Adam this
gay.
Upset since Brian dumped out his rabbit hole.
I know.
Yeah, he's never been this worked up. Elon Musk loves women, right? He's with tons of them.
See, and that's something that I do. I think you guys are just goddamn adorable, you men. You know, you claim to be, and by all intents and purposes, you know, he is the biggest genius on the planet, and stuck with Amber Heard for how long?
Well, she's hot.
Yeah.
Okay. She's pretty hot.
Didn't she have? Okay.
She's hot.
Okay.
So, thing is, first off, nobody is going to do what he has done without collecting a little history. You have to have history. You can't start so many companies. You know, they have to go, he did business with a battery company out of China. Yeah, of course. This is shit that happens when you're building rockets and cars and tunneling and shit. Somebody's going to have some business that's with some country that you don't like, that made something that you don't like, that hurt the environment, where this whole sort of thing where you connect this thing to this thing. Is he a net positive or not for this world? That's my whole thing.
Right.
Is he paying taxes? Is he creating jobs? Is he creating technology? Are we glad he was born?
If we're glad he was born, then
shut the fuck up.
If he finishes that tube thing that shoots you up to San Francisco in 30 minutes, yes.
Hyperloop or whatever it is. Yes. Just
what's
please.
That like if that crashes, though?
And this doesn't make any sense. I literally just put in the words Elon Musk anti-climate just to see what the quotes are. And the first thing that comes up is Elon Musk, my top recommendation for reducing greenhouse gases.
Yes.
Why Elon Musk?
He wants to build a giant carbon scrubber.
Yeah.
His thing is like, you assholes want to stop having nuclear power plants and coal-fired plants and natural gas plants. You're fucking playing. The AOC's, their job, AOC's thing is just stop doing everything all the time. Elon Musk is like, let's figure out a way to fix it.
Right.
So we'll have our power, then he'll build his CO2 scrubbers or whatever he's doing, and then we can have our children can inherit a great Earth.
That'd be
what
nice.
The fuck? It's like what? All these fucking dumb people
what makes
chiming
you more,
in.
What makes you more upset, this or the Jeopardy guy story?
I got that.
Oh, the Jeopardy. Oh,
you didn't do that
it's yet? Like oh
that
no,
one, that one makes
this
me
the best
crazy.
News ever. It's the best news ever because racism is gone because we have to fucking find it everywhere. We gotta. Where's Waldo? It
it's
for
so crazy.
Everything. We have to find it everywhere. when obviously there was a time in this country's history where we didn't need to look that hard for racism. We just look out our front windows. Now we must find it.
This guy, by the way.
It's abundantly clear. He does one, two, and then he does three. It's just he gives the signals.
Well, they say three-time champion, three wins, and that's what he did. He put the three in, which is.
But he also did the first and the second in other episodes. Yes.
He says he's horrified.
He shouldn't be horrified. He should tell all these pussies to fuck themselves.
Yeah. He says, I absolutely unequivocally condemn white supremacy and racism of any kind. I'm not a racist.
You should never do that. This is the whole thing. This is the fucking game they bait you into. Now you have to backpedal and go, I'm not a white supremacist. Of course you're not a white supremacist. You were doing three with your fucking fingers like an umpire would do, or like what a shortstop does. You know, they go one out to the outfield, they go two-way. That's all. Shut the fuck up, pussies.
Devil's advocate, have you ever told somebody to get you three this way before?
That's how I do it.
Is it really?
Yeah, because this is actually the heart of my finger, so I always do like this.
I've
just never said like, yeah, three.
That's how I do it.
So anyway, he's blasting white. And also, what's in it for him to blast white power signs?
You know, all those white power Jeopardy lovers.
All right. Well, it's good news because I think they had the Navy cadets do a stupid thing. There was a whole hubbub 2 years ago where they had a big picture after the Army-Navy game, and they did the same thing, and then they had to do the fucking investigation because there's more white power. But lo and behold, it's nothing.
So
this isn't an issue, everyone, but everyone wants to turn it into something, which is great because it doesn't really exist, and we're fighting tooth and nail to make it something.
By the way, Chris says that both Yang and Brian's posts have been deleted on Twitter. But are things not A-okay anymore? Can we not do that?
I all the time.
I don't know.
This is a bad signal? You can't do this?
I think the upside down one is like...
What's her name?
AD Bryant.
Shut up, everyone. Do your fucking job. Ugh. All right. Let's bring it home.
I'm
angry.
I'm Gina Grad, and that's the news. Shit, yeah!
Gina Grad! That was the news with Gina Grad.
It's such a... Well, here's the problem. The whole problem is we... self-esteem movement. Mm-hmm. We made all these young fucks feel like their opinion needed to be shared with everyone. Back in the day, no 30-year-old would want to coach up Elon Musk. Like, you wouldn't feel like that was within your power.
Right.
You'd be like, fuck, I'll get fired. He's a genius. And I'm a fucking idiot. I'll get shit canned. Like, why are you advertising this? That would have formerly never existed. And also, where's the context? He's some genius, makes electric cars and rocket ships. He's tunneling through the Santa Susana Pass. He's hosting on your show. Why do you have to fuck with him?
You might find him abrasive, but the controversial stuff flies over.
Well,
and
it's like, how could it go any other way? California literally said, go fuck yourself. And he said, understood, and left. And now SNL says, go fuck yourself, understood. Like, how many enemies do you want to create?
I'm skeptical, though, that it's... You also have to consider that the possibility that they're just doing it. Because guess what? I'm going to watch the show.
I haven't watched
SNL all. I'll probably watch it next week.
Yeah.
And maybe they're just doing this to drum it up.
They're
drum up some publicity for the show.
Because I really don't know what the problem is.
Now you're thinking like the Kardashian mom.
That's right.
All right. Let me tell you about LifeLock. Yeah, tax season is scary enough. Now the IRS is warning about ghost tax preparers who don't sign as the paid preparer. And could be a red flag there. It's important to understand how cybercrime and identity theft are affecting our lives. Every day, we put our info at risk on the internet. In an instant, cyber criminals could harm your finances and credit. Good thing, there's LifeLock. LifeLock detects a wide range of identity threats like your social security number for sale on the dark web. If they detect your information has potentially been compromised, they'll send you an alert. You'll have access to a dedicated restoration specialist. It's LifeLock, right, Dawson?
No one can prevent all identity theft or monitor all transactions at all businesses, but you can keep what's yours with LifeLock Identity Theft Protection. Join now and save up to 25% off your first year at LifeLock.com, promo code Adam. That's LifeLock.com, promo code Adam for 25% off.
Comedian Ian Bagg, funny man, is going to be joining us tomorrow. Dan Dunn, What We're Drinking with Dan Dunn, available wherever you get your podcast. And Instagram, The Imbiber, as well. You can go to adamcarolla.com for the live shows. Jam in the Van is coming up May 22nd. We'll do it live. Maybe Dawson will do a little set at the top. He's ready to go. And Golden, Colorado coming up, and Royal Oak, Michigan coming up, and Kansas City, Missouri coming up. You just go to adamcarolla.com for all the live shows and our chassis channel. 687. We have all the stuff there. Pluto TV. And until next time, Adam Carolla for Dan Dunn, Gina Grad, and Mo Brian saying mahalo. I'm going to start looking for some child porn. Mm.